And we are coming down in 3, 2, 1.
Welcome to Getting Sports with Drunk. I'm your host, Cupcake the Riddler, and I'm joined by
Machcine
Washable,
Nay,
White T Souls,
and the Red Baron.
Too bad nobody heard that because we're not on air yet. But I wish you pulled the cord
right out of the window.
Oh man!
Oh fuck!
Oh no!
Yeah, we're here. We're here. We're queer. Deal with it. Get a cut. That's a Family Guy thing too, right?
Yeah.
But yeah, we're here live on the PPRN Radio Network, also streaming on Spreaker.
Yes, sir.
I know Peter wants those plugs. I'm going to give them to him.
It's good.
And you can hear those plugs on Spreaker.
Hey, do you know we're on Spreaker? Kyle, where are we?
In West Haven?
Oh, my God.
Born and raised? I don't know if you guys are getting any of this yet, but I have the beer parts are finally working their way out, and they are pretty rancid.
Good.
Nah,
last night we held our friend group live draft. It was the first time our group ever did a live draft.
Not on Spreaker, but we're on Spreaker.
Greatest thing we've ever done.
And there was a lot of beer drinking. How many Red Dogs were left in the fridge?
None.
Zero.
So there were 60 Red Dogs consumed. There was also just several passing rounds of bottles of Jaeger at some point. The Mass did the usual Mass thing and brought his own six-pack of 16-ounce Coors Lights.
And a matching glass.
Yep.
Hey, he was slanging out on that grill.
But the best part about it is that there's another 30 of Red Dog in Kendall's house.
That's starting to waft over here.
Yeah.
Yeah,
that 30 of Red Dog's for next Monday.
Yes.
We're going to do the same thing, though. We're going to drink 30 of them. Rebecca has to have a beer.
9 beers.
I'll tell you what, I had so much fun at that draft.
You know, how's your hand?
It's okay. It's about the same as when I did the other time. So just as it got better, I did it again. Because I'm an idiot.
All because of Charles Clay.
You know, I was just trying to be like funny, and that's what I get.
He punched it so hard.
What did you hit, the reclining the reclining plastic handle on the couch?
No, I think it was like the wood
the armrest.
Ow.
Why did you just punch a cushion?
Because I'm a dope. I don't do anything like that requires thinking.
But next Monday, which will be September 2nd.
Live on Spreaker.
Yes.
Yeah, on Spreaker. But we'll be doing the GSWD live draft.
Again. Live on Spreaker.
No,
how are we
live
gonna do
the
order for that?
Huh?
We got to come up with a fun way to determine the order.
I mean, well,
dick size. So I'm the last.
Well, yes. You still lose to Rebecca.
Oh,
her prosthetic.
She's got a mean clitoris.
Kendall, does she have a penis?
Of course. That's what the whole point of this show is about, right?
Show.
We can leave it up to the wheel to decide.
I'll take 7, but I'm not happy about it.
All right.
Or 2. I'm good with 2.
What about 1?
No, she can have 1.
Well, now, wait a minute.
Anybody but Mark gets 1.
I might take McCaffrey.
I'm taking Bears defense first overall.
We will no longer be on screen. All right, starting lineup, guys. What are you drinking?
I have from Rhode Island a Natagasseret Lager.
It's Rhode Island.
You know, I knew someone was going to say
it's Rhode Island. Rhode Island Natagasseret Lager.
Hi, neighbor.
What's up, man?
Kyle, how do you pronounce neighbor?
Nabor.
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 Sold on merit.
What do you got, Solzy?
So, I'm drinking the same thing I drank last week, but it's first this time. It's citrus from Funk Brewing.
feel like we're missing a certain allure of energy. I feel like we're all kind of like still just like a little.
I woke up a little groggy.
I mean, we went pretty hard. I was saying about early, like, we started drinking, and then we just, like, turned the switch and ripped it off the wall.
It kind of went off the rails.
Yeah. Well, when you start a fantasy draft with everyone shotgunning a beer, it's not really going to slow down from there.
We had one team draft 5 quarterbacks.
Yeah, I don't know what we're going to do tomorrow when we enter. I don't think Yahoo's going to let us put 5.
I think you could do it.
I don't we might have to... We don't have to fudge with the roster, like, capacities.
What? I mean, you can have anybody on your bench.
No. No. When you do a standard league, there's a limit to a certain amount of people you can have. Hmm. Like, usually, like, it's, like, something, like, usually... Most leagues, like, set it up where you can't have more than, like, 3 defenses. You can't have more than, like, 2 kickers. You can't have more than 4 quarterbacks. And they do it for that whole... Like, not that Vinny did this, but it, like, avoids people, like, doing it where it's, like... Something I contemplate doing every year, which is
hoarding,
getting the if I ever like it's because I never gotten the 10th pick. If I ever got the 10th pick, I would have done it. Like this year, I would have right out of the gate. Mahomes and Rodgers gets back to me like Breeze and Rivers, like Goff. Like I would have just kept doing it until people, and then just been like, trade me.
Well, I mean, at that point, I would just kind of let you suffer.
No, you wouldn't. You'd want somebody,
but at that point, like. Your team's like a guaranteed win.
That's not true.
How?
Because I would after I got the 6 quarterbacks, I wanted to go out and get a bunch. I wouldn't have any bench players, but I would still have a starting lineup. And if anybody knows my fantasy football game, it's the waiver wires. Too bad we turned those off this year.
What are you drinking, Paul?
I have Rainy Day Band-Aid Blues from Czech Style Lager. From Still Hill Brewery here in Rocky Hill, Connecticut.
Oh, I thought you were going to say Seymour.
Butts?
That's right.
Baron, okay. Red.
Also from Still Hill Brewery in Rocky Hill, Connecticut, I have the Summer Ale. It's a Belgian Patter-style beer. I had never seen that word on a can before.
Toast of excellence. Believe we can make Mako last.
As long as no one takes mine.
Everybody on 3. No. Go ahead, Mark.
Mine, I mean, it's the big news of this week is to Andrew Luck hanging it up. I audibly yelled, what the fuck, when I read, because I was painting and our group text was going nuts. I'm like, what the hell is going on? Like, I was like, oh my God.
It's a sad day. I was like,
what happened? It's like, Andrew Luck retired. What?
Who cares?
Shut up. But, I mean, the guy, he played what, 7 years?
He was in the league for 7 years, but he only played 6.
And, I mean, when he was on the field, the guy was
awesome.
Great. I mean, I always liked him a lot. It's too bad his career went the way it did, but it was fun to watch him play.
Well, it's a trend we're seeing, you know? I mean, he's definitely the highest caliber player to do it, but we're seeing a lot of people that have had some injury issues in the first few years of their career. Hang it up because they don't want to, you know. You look at, like, some of these players. Like, you look at someone like a Johnny Knox. Like, Johnny Knox, his career ended because he couldn't play football. Because he got such a bad spinal injury that if something had ever happened, he would have lost his ability to walk. Much like what's going to happen with, like, Ryan Shazier, what happened with Zach Miller from the Bears. You know, but these are all young guys. And, like, they didn't get the option. They can't come back and play football. Like, they're just not going to be able to. But, like, how bad could it have been? I mean, Zach Miller almost lost his leg. Like, it was seconds from losing his leg. Ryan Shazier was probably, like, a 2-degree, the way he bent, 2 degrees difference, and he's never walking again. Johnny Knox almost never walked again. I mean, these guys look at those players, and look how lucky they are. Like, let's get out while we still, like, have the ability to do physical things.
And that was kind of, I don't know if you guys watched his press conference. He kind of said that. He's like, you know, for 4 years I've been... in pain and rehabbing constantly.
Yeah, it's been...
He's like, I can't do it
it's
anymore.
Been pain, playing, pain, playing, pain, rehab, playing, pain, playing, pain, rehab.
You know, and it's too bad. Back? What's that?
Think he comes back?
I don't know. I mean, he definitely has an matchable love for the game.
Yeah.
He was completely devoted to his team. You know, he was never the guy that was... You know, going out for big, was going to go for big bucks somewhere else, you know, like the Kirk Cousins route or anything like that. I mean, maybe if staying off the field, but staying in shape for this season and maybe next season can kind of get all of his injuries. You know, I don't really know much about his injuries, if they are long lasting, like continuously nagging, like Cam Newton's shoulder, like that. He's going to have like work done on it every off season to remove cartilage and things like are they like injuries like that? Or are they injuries that just because he's been playing and stuff, like he just hasn't had a chance to fully recover?
I don't think he comes back, because I don't think he would play anywhere other than Indy. And I think they're going to start to, I mean, they have no choice but to move on from him.
Right.
So I don't think that he'll come back. And
it also,
like,
depends what happens with his personal life, too. I mean, you think he's married, so who knows? Maybe him and his wife have a kid during the course, you know, or
nine kids.
Plan to have a kid during the course of the season or something like that. And then, you know, a lot of the times, you know, these players, like, they get those, the taste of home life and, like, being around their kid all the time, and they don't want to turn it back. I mean, the NFL, it's...
Yeah.
The NFL is a little bit more, you have more luxury in the NFL than you do in any of the other sports, because you don't go on, you know, like, week to 2 week long road trips. Because, like, in the NFL, you would go, if you were playing an away game, if they were playing the Texans, they'd get there on Friday and then come home on Monday, maybe Sunday night.
Sunday night, yeah.
And then they would practice at home all week, and then if they had another away game, they'd leave again.
Yeah.
Like, but, you know, it's not like baseball where, like, you have, you know, 15...
6 weeks.
Yeah, 15 to 20, 25 straight games on the road where you're just in from hotel to hotel, basketball to, you know, even hockey. Like, you have that home life.
Do you think Luck ends up in, like, the announcing booth at all? I can see it, because he's kind of got the personality for it.
He's got the personality, but I don't know if he really has the verbal skills. Because he, like, just because he stumbles on his words a lot, and he's got a, like, not a thick accent. Like, he almost kind of has that, like, southern, like, draw. But, like, it's almost like...
Yeah, I don't even know what you call it.
Yeah. Retarded? Like, I don't know. Like, he's just, like, got a very, like, slow, but, like, he doesn't really, like, catch his words. Like,
I think if he comes back to football, it's no more than just being a college head coach.
You don't think he has pro talent of any sort?
I just don't think that he'll do it. I think at the college level, well, he'll do it. Like, University of Stanford, get them back on the map.
My thing is... What the real shame is that he didn't do enough to get into the Hall of Fame.
He's not a Hall of Famer. I mean,
but he guaranteed would have been.
Oh yeah,
he played his career. But
absolutely.
But that's like the thing, you know. Like you look at these, like will Ryan Shazier get in the Hall of Fame? Probably not. Would he have been a Hall of Famer? More than likely. There's a pretty good chance. But there's no guarantee. Like, Zach Miller probably wouldn't have been a Hall of Famer. You know, Johnny Knox was still young when that happened. You know, you look at these, like, Jason Worlds from the Steelers. God, well, our guys do this a lot, huh?
Well, he went out to go, like, worship God.
Well, no, but he left because of concussions.
Luck, I think, if he played a full 15-year career, he would have been
Hall of Famer. It was just like Calvin Johnson played long enough to probably get that bid.
Yeah.
You know, like, and did enough record-wise to do it. You know what I'm saying? Like Andrew Luck set records, but, like, rookie records or, like, top first 5 years in the league records. Records that we see that Mahomes will break. And then maybe Mayfield breaks those. And that, you know, and then we see, like, Rosen and then these guys. Like, you know, there's always just guys that coming up that, you know. For Christ's sakes, Nick Foles is tied for the most touchdowns in a game.
Well, we don't know who's going to Indianapolis next year.
Nick Foles.
Justin Herbert.
See, I don't know. I mean, we can see how the year plays out, but I think they're behind Brissett.
I'd like to talk about this more, but I also want to open this beer.
Oh yeah, yeah. We still have Toast of Excellence.
I would like to talk this more.
Go ahead, Souls.
My Toast of Excellence is to the newborn crew, Aaron Harper, Bryce's new baby.
K-R-E-W.
Yeah.
No, fucking terrible.
You know, if this was last year, Kyle wouldn't have done that.
You're right. Whatever. It is what it is. I also picked the Ravens.
It's an overrated baby. Manny Machado's son.
Overrated. Also, fucking picked our goddamn Ravens defense yesterday.
Yeah, it was funny.
Good thing it's only going to be for week one.
Tell Bob.
I already did.
He disowned him.
Now he goes, who are they playing? Miami. All right.
Kendall?
Pistol Pete for the Mets, tying the Mets home run record, 41.
Okay, no. No.
Why?
It's not his nickname.
It is.
It's not.
I didn't come up with it.
It's Pete Maravich's.
All right, well, you tell the internet.
Will do.
Get on there.
Milwaukee best coming at you.
Twitter, the Facebook beef we've been waiting for.
Riddler?
I just don't know. I don't know.
Yeah, I have one.
The Team Australia for beating the United States for the first time ever in men's international basketball.
Sure.
Why you not? Have it.
Well, our team kind of really blows right now. Nobody wants to play.
We've had 19 gold medals in a row. Not 19. Richard Jefferson was on the one that they became bronze.
I'm glad that that's the guy you picked.
Yeah, he sucked. He didn't no reason to be on that team.
So, Jacoby Brissett.
I don't know. I'm not discounting Jacoby Brissett. I mean, he's started, what, 15, 17 games? He's not won them all, but he's played well. I mean, he played well when he had the starting role after Garoppolo got hurt those first four games in the Brady era, the Brady suspension. And then he came into Indy and he played games when Luck couldn't play. Didn't he play the whole season Luck didn't play? Pretty much, for the most part, I think.
Didn't win.
Huh?
Didn't win.
But that was also a team that their defense was trash.
Their defense was on the rise. They still have a good offensive line. You know, they've got the young guy in Marlon Mack. They still got T.Y. Hilton.
Yeah. Brissett is in, like, the golden seat right now. I mean, if he goes out and just has an average year, they're going to re-sign him. You know, like...
It's a make-or-break year for him.
Oh, absolutely.
But I think if he sucks, they're going to look the other way.
But this was a guy that was looking like he was just going to be, like, a career backup. And he's now in the
plus he's mobile. He's not run first mobile, but he's mobile. He can move. And I mean here's the deal. He's in a tough seat. You know, he was pretty much handed the opportunity to win a starting job. But he's got to go through three of the top 10 defenses twice to do it.
Yeah.
Plus, whoever else is on their schedule. I don't know the Colts schedule off the top of my head. But
play the Steelers, I know that. And they play the Chargers.
But, I mean, really, if you look at some of the quarterbacks, I mean, we've seen guys get their opportunities because of injuries.
Yeah.
You know.
Tom Brady.
Yeah. I mean, really, Brady, Romo, like, guys that.
Dak.
Yeah. Guys that, we you know, get talked about as being good to great to, you know, Brady's in that GOAT conversation, but.
Is that the Colts schedule?
Yeah, for this year.
Right, you know, not to say Jacoby Brissett is the new Tom Brady, but he's...
I think that's what you're saying.
I mean, really, you look at... imagine you get your shot at starting full-time. Like, you're the starter on a team that was somewhat projected to be a Super Bowl contender. I mean, yes, Luck was part of that, but the team is good. You know, he's not the starter now for Miami.
Right.
Where it's just like, oh, I'm going to get lit up and blamed for it.
Well, it was interesting, too. For whatever reason, I thought that he was older than he is.
No, he's young.
Yeah, I just pulled up his stats a moment ago. And I was like, oh, only 2016. For whatever reason, it seems like he's been around a long time. But.
I mean, he's a guy that really just it fell into his lap nice, you know. Like Paul said, he's got a good defense, the best, I mean, last year's best offensive line, decent running back, and a good receiving core.
You know, it's interesting, too, because he played the majority of the 2017 season. It's like, I don't remember anything, like, noteworthy.
Because that was, the team itself wasn't that great. Like, the Colts last year were kind of like a surprise that they got so good.
Kyle called that, too, I'm pretty sure.
Yep.
Usually but it's funny. What I mean by that is like,
that's not true.
You're usually wrong.
But I don't remember anything like bad either from him. It was like nothing.
It will be interesting to see. I mean, because he is kind of a fun quarterback to watch. Because like Paul said, I mean, he can move around. He's got a decent arm. It's just now it's his prove it time. I was reading a thing today. He doesn't have an agent.
Oh, really?
They said, like, sports agents were, like, fighting each other to try to get to him. Because he's in his contract. Like, if he goes out and balls out, like, say he makes the playoffs, he's going to, you know, Garoppolo got that huge payday off doing nothing.
Yeah, but where's he going to go?
The Colts.
Yeah, but, like, what if the Colts don't want to pay him?
Well, then, hey, I mean,
You know what I'm saying? No, but who's going to sign him? He's not going to be a starter.
So you don't think if he makes the playoffs this year, he won't get a chance to be a starter?
Pick a team that needs a quarterback besides Indianapolis. Unless you go to Tennessee and then.
But I mean,
potentially. If he balls out, think about this. If he balls out and takes and wins the division for the Colts.
I think the Colts re-sign him then. But if they don't.
Even if they don't. I know a certain team that's having a lot of issues working a contract out with their quarterback right now.
Dallas.
Yeah. That's right. Like, if he, especially if he wins the division, but even if they get a what and they make the playoffs, someone's going to pay him. I mean, because we've seen in the, like, Matt Cassel made the, they missed the playoffs, but I mean, he went 11-5.
Yeah. Played well enough to make the playoffs.
Yeah. Got the payday from the Chiefs, and I mean, sucked, but. That's not the point.
Sucked butt.
That's not the point.
You didn't do it on purpose. You said sucked butt.
I mean, if Brissett puts some wins together, then someone's going to pay him. And I think it would be the Colts just because he's been in the system, in their system for, this is what, his third year now. I mean, why go elsewhere? Because you got to figure, if they make the playoffs, they're not going to have that high pick to draft one of the top guys this year. So who are they going to get?
Right.
You know?
All right. No, I get that.
I wonder if there was ever a moment where they entertained the thought about trying to trade for anybody.
Like, since Luck retired?
Yeah.
Well, two names that they probably could have traded for. Both being Josh McCown.
That would be awesome.
Or Ryan Fitzpatrick.
Oh, that would really be it.
Think about it. Why not let the Dolphins just fucking start Josh Rosen? If they suck, they know to pick somebody else.
I don't think the Dolphins want to do that. I think they want Rosen, and they'll let him kind of season up a little bit and not just throw him to the Wolves like the Cardinals did. I mean, I think the Colts believe in Brissett, and they're going to give him his chance. I don't think they're going to trade for anybody and put the doubt in his head that the front office doesn't believe in him. I think they'll let him roll.
They got a good coach, too, so we'll see how it all plays out.
Talking Indianapolis?
Yeah, Frank Reich.
All right.
Good on you, Frank.
See, Case Keenum was named the starter of the Redskins?
I did see that.
It's the right move.
Well, it's like, you know, you get what you get. If he plays great, well, hey, good on you. If he doesn't, well, it's Case Keenum.
Yeah, so you can't blame the Redskins.
Right. They got nothing really going on.
If he starts to suck, then you ride it out with Haskins.
I was going to say something and I forgot now.
We're all like waiting for you over there.
Oh my God. I was
Gave
gonna
that I'm going to talk inhale.
Yeah.
You know what? Broncos will sign him. They've been cycling through quarterback for a while.
Who? Case?
Jacoby Brissett.
Oh, Jacoby Brissett. Yeah, maybe.
Oh, they like Flacco.
They might like him, but they like to do things with quarterbacks.
Elway's not good at evaluating the quarterback.
And, you know, imagine, too, like, Flacco goes out there and just craps the bed. He's like, then what do you do?
I hope not. I just put a waiver in for him in one of my leagues.
I don't think that happens.
Because I realized I didn't draft the quarterback.
I don't think that
Can Flacco you believe it? I didn't draft the quarterback. I forgot to draft the quarterback in a league. I just kept saying to myself, like, yeah.
I can wait.
No, it was in my head. I had Rivers, but I never drafted him. Just never did.
Mike didn't pick a quarterback till late last night.
Yeah.
I ended up with Ben again.
I was going to take him, and then Paul did.
Who'd you end up with?
Kirk Cousins.
You happy with it?
You know, not totally, but, I mean, Cousins, he always gets a lot of yards. I have the stack with Thielen. So I'm anticipating, like, the first 6 weeks it's going to be pretty dynamic, and then it's going to fall apart.
Not going to finish the year 6-11.
No, because by then, Vinny's going to have to drop some of his quarterbacks.
I'm going to try to snatch some of those guys up.
You know, so once that happens, there'll be some more guys in the pool, but...
Well, two of them I'm not even going to worry about.
Yeah.
Being Daniel Jones and Kyler Murray.
Kyler Murray, I think, could be sneaky good this year. Especially for fantasy.
Yeah.
Especially for fantasy.
I got two good quarterbacks. I'm good.
But, I mean, really, like, you got to fit. Kyler Murray can run, and he has a good arm. He's a good passer.
No, he's not.
He is.
He's not.
All right. But
prove it.
He is.
Prove it. I want to do a pass, punt, and kick contest with him right now.
He shows up.
Hey, Kyler, thanks for coming. So you answered our Evite.
But I think Kyler can be very effective. Similar, I mean, even
I
if
think
it's
Kendall
not
deserves
on his
a
arm.
Shot for that.
For what, the Evite?
Yeah.
Why?
Because it's stupid.
All right, fine. Pour it up.
All right, fine.
But you have to do it.
What, the shot?
No, you have to pour it.
You're right next to it.
Nope, you determined it has to be poured, so you have to do it.
You're right next to it.
Kyle, how do you think Chad Kelly's going to do it?
Kyle, just untwist the top. Why would you rip it again?
Why? To piss you off. Is it working?
Don't we have an open package?
Yes, and it's twisted, but he's opening it again.
Who twists things?
This guy Chad Kelly looks like Kyle, anybody you could have ever gone to high school
then
with.
I'm just going to leave it here. Because you're right there.
Chad Kelly.
Doesn't the guy, he just looks like he went to high school with him, like it just did some.
Oh, his name's Swag Kelly?
Oh, I didn't know that. It was a dollar sign through the S. This guy's the real deal.
Where's he a backup?
Indianapolis.
Oh.
He had a start. No, he didn't have a start in Denver, but he did have a game played. He rushed for 1 yard.
Negative one.
Negative. So I wonder if it was like a botched field goal.
Or did he come out to take a knee?
Yep, that's it. 100%.
That's got to suck.
Yeah, just ruining his stats.
Who would he have came in for last year?
Keenum? It was in Denver, so...
Brock?
Yeah, maybe. Well, whatever that...
Osweiler was starting for them last year?
He might go to the last year.
Right? Is that what it was?
Was it last year?
Last year, yeah.
Oh, then Keenum.
Wait, wasn't Brock there, though? Didn't he go back?
No, Brock was in Miami.
No, he was there last year.
I think he went back after Miami.
He got cut.
During the season?
Kenno, pull up Brock Osweiler.
Are you sure?
I think so.
I think he ended the year in Denver. He ended up playing a lot of games for him.
Probably didn't spell his name right. Oh, look, here it is. 2017 was in Denver.
Ah, then he went to Miami.
Then he was in Miami.
Okay.
I know, because he beat the Bears last year. He's undefeated against the Bears.
That's an amazing thing that happened with Houston. Goes there, signs that.
Monster deal. Craps the bed.
Big time.
Cuts him, and he goes back to Denver.
Yeah, I mean, God. Like, we talk about this stuff all the time, like, you know, hindsight 2020. But what if he just stayed in Denver? Would his life, his career have been different? Would it have been better?
Probably not.
He sucked in Denver.
I get a couple of
he just had
moments.
A good defense for him.
Yeah, that's true. But, you know, he put together like a win or two.
He wasn't bad that year. I mean... Then they took him out to put Peyton in the playoffs, and he just kind of hobbled his way to a Super Bowl. But
hey, I like to see that.
Me too. It was good.
We've been rooting for the Broncos if Osweiler was the quarterback.
I just remember that Super Bowl watching Peyton Manning, and it was rough. He was just out there throwing duck balls. He couldn't move. Just like, all right, guys, just get me through this game.
Hey, he threw that laser 2-point conversion, though.
Remember that awesome reverse he had, though?
Oh,
the
yeah.
The fake reverse.
Like in that record-setting year versus the Ravens. Oh, it's beautiful. Just running on this. No one around him. He's like, God, that guy's 150 years old.
Don't hit him.
Football raised in the air.
Just fumbles.
Tries to pull it in. It's a touchback.
But yeah, I'm very excited for football to start.
We got next week, right?
Next Thursday.
Thursday. All right, I was telling
you. Oh, yeah, I'm going to ask on air just because I don't want to forget. Unless it's a 6 o'clock game, can you bring Kyle home next Thursday after the game? The softball game?
No.
Please?
Yeah.
Well, just because I don't want to miss the Bears.
Gotcha.
If it's a 6 o'clock game, I can pick him up at 7. Probably just swing by Wallingford on the way home from work. I don't want to do that, but I will.
I'm making my announcement on the air, and you guys actually all have me pretty much beat, but I'm going to grow a beard the entire football season, so if you guys like to join me, you can keep your pre-existing, but...
Everyone goes fresh, clean shave Wednesday night.
I can't. Last time I shaved my face completely clean,
yeah,
my daughter wouldn't talk to me for like 2 days.
So if you want to participate, please do, and you can keep your pre-existing beard. Kyle has a good one going. Kind of got the... Not the Matt Garza. It's better. It's better than...
Roberto Garza. The Roberto Garza.
Souls, comments, concerns?
Fuck Matt Garza.
Do you mean that?
Yeah, he's not good.
Do you mean that, though?
Yeah.
I'm saying you got a nice beard. That's what
Thank
I'm
you.
Saying.
Why are you being so mean to Roberto Garza?
So does Rebecca, though. Yeah, I know.
Yeah, it's blonde, though. Blonde beard. Looks like a
gay pirate. Blonde beard.
Blonde. Less intensity. But, yeah, growing that beard should be good.
Well, so while we're on the subject of the AFC South, and, you know, we had our first big injury news of the year so far. You guys want to talk about Lamar Miller going down, what it means for the Texans this year?
I don't think it changes anything.
Well, it's interesting because Lamar Miller, he's...
I mean, it sucks for him being a contract year.
Yeah.
Granted, he's kind of like, he's missed the... He kind of missed that opportunity to get that really big contract because, like, he played, like, well enough in Miami to get a good deal with the Texans, but I feel like he kind of played, like...
Average?
Not average, but he just played, like, the twilight of his career. I mean, he was good last year for them.
He was a Pro Bowler last year, wasn't he?
Yeah.
I mean, he was effective. It's just...
He's a serviceable guy. Yeah. Nothing flashy.
Well, can you pull up his stats from last year?
Oh, sure.
Yeah. Thought you were going to do that.
Well, I was going to pull up the season.
You thought wrong.
Well, nice.
Yeah. Douchebag.
Whoa.
Well, Souls, go back to what you were saying, though. It doesn't change anything?
I don't think it changes anything.
Elaborate.
I had to swallow. I think Duke Johnson could be just as good as him there. And he's a more reliable pass catcher.
You know, Kyle high-fived me after almost every one of my picks last night and said good pick, and then told me my team was trash on the way home last night.
I didn't do that.
So we're looking at Lamar Miller's stats. So you figure he only played in 14 games, so he missed two, probably, what, injury, whatever?
Yeah, probably.
So you got to figure if he played all 16, he's over 1,000 rushing yards.
Oh, I can't see the numbers.
He finished with 973 yards with 5 touchdowns. So, I mean, he would have been over 1,000 yards. And he had, what, 163 receiving yards and a touchdown. So, I mean, he's not a great pass-catching back, but serviceable enough. But the Texans also didn't run those types of plays that often.
Right. I mean, very traditional-style running back.
The thing with the, unless it's a designed pass to the running back, Deshaun Watson didn't have enough time to go through his progressions and then just check it down. He was, you know, by the time he got
running for his life.
Basically, this is how Deshaun Watson's thought process went last year on every single pass play. If it was play action, it was like, all right, and sack. So
run.
Right, but if it was a normal pass play, it was like. And hike, Hopkins, throw, nah, whatever happens.
Yeah, I do that.
It's not a real interception if it goes to him.
So we started a team with the Texans, and I feel like Deshaun Watson. I say hike, and they're there.
So what I did was, in this year, because I tried to change it up. So I made Kyle the quarterback. I made him extremely mobile with great speed, good throw on the run, but no deep ball accuracy, and not a really powerful arm. Like, in terms of, like, the zip. Mm-hmm. And then to change it up, because it's just, like, it's so easy to just keep in. I made myself a slow, poor route running tight end with amazing hands, really big, good blocker. And let me tell you something. When I'm not trying to fuck around with the impact versus finesse block, because if you can get the right one on the guy, you slam him to the ground. If I don't push buttons, I can hold, like, I held Joey Bosa. Like, without even getting pressure the whole game.
The best description from what you just said was poor route running.
Well, so here's the
real deal. Stiff.
Well, because, like, the thing is, that when you're playing, unless you're, like a real asshole, sorry to the people that do this, but nobody, if you're a wide receiver, like, nobody runs the routes. So, like, for me, I basically always just run across the field in some, however deep everybody else is going. If he's got all the receivers going deep, I run a deeper cross route perpendicular to everybody else. And then if he doesn't throw it, I just start working my way back. Souls, does that check out for you?
Yeah. But there's some times, though, where he's standing sideways and doesn't do anything. Not his fault, but that's kind just the game being the game.
Game being the game, yeah.
And it bothered me because it happened three times. I would have been led to a pick.
But yeah, Lamar Miller, I'm kind of on the Kyle side. I think with or without him, the team doesn't fall on – the success doesn't fall on Lamar Miller suiting up for them. I think he's effective and it's a good guy to have, but I don't think he's the guy who's going to make changes that put the Texans over in games.
No, but I think it definitely would have given – it would have been better to have that 1-2 punch of, like, both serious running backs.
All this means is that the Browns are just going to get a fucking third-round pick instead of a fourth-round pick. Duke Johnson's going to put up fucking numbers to put up to get a third-round pick.
Well, I mean, we don't exactly know that. I mean – they signed Ajayi for a reason. Not saying he's great, but I mean, Duke Johnson's not a great between the tackles. Right? He's a good pass catching back, but he's not a between the tackles guy. So I mean, Ajayi's gonna take work from him in that sense. So I mean,
it's gonna take at least a few weeks.
Oh, I know, but I mean, they're both just as new to the system.
Well, no, it's not that. It's like he just got cleared.
Who?
Jai.
But I mean, it's not like Duke Johnson is all of a sudden like, all right, you're our workhorse. Like, we believe in you. He just got there 2 weeks ago. Like,
too bad they don't have Alfred Blue anymore.
I can't believe I heard his name twice in 24 hours.
I think that's going to be just a more of a committee unless someone breaks out. You know, if week one, Duke Johnson can rush for, you know, 80 yards and a touchdown and receive, then yeah, he'll take the starting role. But I mean, we've seen Ajayi come out and explode in games. So
is that a shot towards me?
No, is it not true, Kyle?
Oh, it is. I'm just asking.
I mean,
you
really
said it. There's a word "shot." It definitely like took a shot. You know,
I didn't even say that.
You did.
I said he exploded in a game.
Sorry, he exploded.
Kyle, he rushed for over 200 yards in two separate games.
Yeah, and guess what? Got stuck in the playoffs.
Okay.
Overrated bitch.
So we have the Texans schedule up, and it looks it's very top heavy, difficult early, and I'm looking at the Saints, Jags, Chargers, Panthers, Falcons, Chiefs, Colts, Raiders, Jags, before the bye week.
Dick Chen.
And honestly, I don't know how many of those games they win. Maybe you beat Jacksonville. You beat the Panthers, maybe. The Raiders.
This Andrew Luck thing is interesting, though, because it really opens up the door for the whole division.
Oh, yeah, for sure.
Because if we don't know, we predict we're going to get that whole, you know, 50% quality from Nick Foles thing.
Yeah.
But their defense only got better. And the only reason their defense didn't play up to the caliber it did was kind of like the Minnesota Vikings thing, where it was just like they were on the field all the fucking time. Like, your defense can only be so good if they're always playing.
Right. I enjoyed Ramsey, though, getting kind of thrown all over.
That usually happens when cornerbacks get really mouthy.
Yeah.
He didn't get thrown all over.
He kind of did.
No.
God, why are you disputing this?
I'm not. But team took more shots, but didn't mean he still had, like, a lot of pass deflections and all that shit. It's not like he got roasted.
He kind of did.
No, not like Darrell Revis's last couple years.
Yeah, but Revis wasn't, a big talker.
And he was
Revis
also old.
Yeah, Revis was, like, 100 years old.
He wasn't. He was, like, 32.
Jalen Ramsey's, what, 24?
God, the lifespan of a cornerback is, like...
Yeah, but Jalen Ramsey also goes up against, like, two really good receivers twice a year.
No, I understand that.
Darrell Revis didn't.
What are you, a Ramsey fan all of a sudden?
No, but he's not like... You're making it out to seem like he fucking got 300 yards against him every fucking game.
No, that's not what I'm saying at all. I'm saying that...
It's what you're saying.
Versus what he did the previous year and the amount of stuff he talked, he did not measure up to what he was saying, is what I'm saying. You know what I'm saying?
I know what you're saying. But you know what I'm saying?
No.
Because you're wrong.
No. We're on a Spreaker, by the way. Just so you guys know. I mean, I have to pull up the stats for Ramsey to really... I didn't realize this was going to be a discussion.
Go ahead.
I didn't want it to be a discussion.
Go ahead. It's like when Josh...
You brought up somebody, that's generally hated by the NFL population, and you didn't expect Kyle to come bat you on it?
I guess I'm in the wrong. All right, are these stats going to be helpful, Lewis? Let's see here.
I did see a stat, though, that was very funny. It was like somebody posted it. It was like an NFL page. It wasn't the NFL, but like a football page. And they posted, like, Jalen Ramsey hit, like, 9 picks in his last 3 years. Like, this guy's lights out. And I was like, Kyle Fuller had 7 last year. Why are we not talking more about him? I mean, yeah, he looks like a fucking alien, but...
Yeah, these stats I pull up really don't help us at all. I mean, I'm not going to go off the interceptions because he's never been, like, a big interception guy.
They don't throw at him.
Let's see what we got here.
It pissed me off, but he clamped Brown down for most of the game.
I wish that the stats here showed how many passes were thrown at him.
I could do it game by game, but...
Well, no, there
got a calculator?
Are you on Pro Football Reference?
Yeah.
There should be an advanced stats section.
Let's see. Yeah, we can keep talking, too. You know, everyone else.
No, we're trying
to watching what you do.
Yeah. Right, defense player news.
Hold on now.
Wow.
Pretty cool.
Shut up, Ken.
All right.
Yeah, you fucking jamoke. Am I gonna have to do this, Kendall?
Yes.
I don't see it.
All right, let's see.
But the Pro Football Focus, we'll find out this year where he ranks among all corners.
Yeah, but I don't care about that.
It's very funny, though, when I see that on Sunday Night Football.
Pro Football Focus? Who's trending up? Oh, Peter.
Jay Glazer's got the inside scoop.
That guy's awful. I hate that guy.
JJ Watt. University of Wisconsin. Got the fucking 12 on there in the bottom.
Pro Football Focus. That's a nice reference. I like that. Something I always pay attention to. It's like, yeah, great. Whatever.
Well, he's ranked 15th.
Yeah, like when that list like initially comes out, like you never hear about it. It's always, like, after the fact.
Hey, guys, here's the 2011 Pro Football Focus list.
Oh, thanks, Mom.
Just came out.
Rich chuckled the Oval Team.
You sounded like the kid on the commercial.
Yeah, have you guys ever even tried that before?
Yeah, I don't like it.
No.
It's not good?
No. You never had it?
No.
Oh,
I refused to. I'm like, I don't want this. I'd rather just have Nesquik.
Yeah, Nesquik's the way to go, as far as your powdered chocolate variety goes.
Your powdered chocolate milk drink.
I'm a big Yoo-Hoo fan myself. It's not a milk.
All right, so last year he gave up 78 receptions on 128 targets, but he only gave up 642 yards, 3 touchdowns. He had 12 breakups, 4 interceptions, and was responsible for 455 total defensive, like,
plays,
finishes. So whether it was, like, disrupting a run, causing a redirection, you know, in a zone coverage, like, resulting in covering on a route that went in an incompletion, something along those lines.
Mm-hmm. What's that AV stat? Can you hover over that?
AV? Approximate value. I don't know what that means.
it's 10.
As a description, is our attempt to attach a single number to every player season since 1960. So you have to see something else to have it explained to you, though.
Can you pull up the glossary?
Thanks, Pro Football Reference. All right, well, anyway, I don't like the guy, and I think he didn't have the season that he talked up to me.
Okay. That's better.
I pretty much said the same
thing. You pretty much said he sucked.
I didn't say he sucked. You did. Where are you getting this from?
It's just like how he thought Josh Norman sucked that year.
Who said
that? What year?
Him and Odell Beef in Carolina.
I'd say he sucked.
I'll forever hate Odell Beckham for that.
That's so stupid, Kyle. But Juju hitting perfect in the head was okay. He did.
Didn't hit him in the head.
Hit him right in his face.
He hit a defensive linebacker with a shoulder.
A defenseless linebacker.
With a shoulder. You didn't hit him with that. Okay, you didn't see him flying 45 yards from the fucking opposite side to go hit him in the head.
Never once said Odell was right. Yeah, but you're going to say that's why you don't like him. And that's asinine.
There's way more to that game why I don't like him. He was a little bitch. Tom Coughlin should have benched
his ass. So, because he was getting late hit on every play, that was okay?
He did the same shit.
That's not what I asked you.
Dun, 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 dun,
I don't.
So.
Okay, how about this? I think he was a bitch the whole game. They both were. But he was more of the bigger bitch for what he did at the end.
For we're talking about Beckham and Norman?
Yeah.
Yeah.
He cemented the bitch in that.
So, again, it was okay when Norman hit him twice after the play, once in the head. That was cool.
Did he fly 50 yards from the other side?
No, answer the question. He got hit late twice and then retaliated. He was wrong, but the lead up is just as bad.
No, it's not. It's all about what gets caught. They never catch the initiate. They always catch the retaliate.
What was the line he just said? A well-liked player in the NFL?
What?
I think he just said a well-liked player in the NFL. You don't expect
that. Yeah, exactly. No, not a well player. No, it's just you got a known disliked player by the NFL community, and you didn't expect Kyle to defend him?
I know, I found that so funny.
Because it's true, Kyle loves all the people hate.
Yep.
I love you, Kyle.
Sports hipster.
He is a sports hipster. He thinks Baker Mayfield's going to be the worst quarterback to ever play in the Browns uniform. You know, he thinks Johnny Manziel's better than Baker Mayfield.
No, I don't.
You do.
I don't.
You do.
I don't.
You do.
I don't.
Show me the money. Money talks, yo.
I would like for him to be better than Baker Mayfield.
Why?
He was more fun.
How do you figure?
In what world was Johnny Manziel more fun than Mayfield?
Dude.
It's because you don't like Baker because he's a Brown.
No, that's not it. Because I don't hate all Browns.
No,
it's
because he's a quarterback for the Browns when everyone's getting behind the Browns. Yeah. And now that the Bengals suck, the Browns are the new Bengals. So now Kyle's going to be like, oh, I actually like Andy Dalton. You said it like 2 weeks ago.
No, I said he doesn't suck.
No, you said you like Andy Dalton.
You said it because when we did our guilty pleasures thing with Mock Skyping in, you said, I like Andy Dalton. Go back on Spreaker, which we're streaming on, by the way, and you can listen to it. I think that's a great segue into a break. We're going to take a break. We'll be back in like 5 to 10 minutes. We usually always take longer than we say.
I got to take a nap or something.
And then when we come back, I believe we're going to do some fantasy talk.
Yeah.
All right, Souls, your time to shine. Fantasy talk.
I'm not going to dispute every time. So.
That's fine. That's what the point of the show is. Well, every time someone argues, they have to drink all the private stocks.
Kyle, you're right.
Kyle would be like, no, I'm not. All right, we'll be back in 5 to 10 minutes. Enjoy your George Strait Radio on Spreaker.
And now, back to Getting Sports with Drunk on the PPRN Radio Network.
Welcome back to Getting Sports with Drunk. I'm your host, Cupcake the Riddler, and I'm joined by All Dogs Go to Heaven.
Yeah, man.
Has Madison seen it yet?
Nah. He said he might watch it because he didn't know Burt Reynolds played like one of the guys.
Oh, I'm all in now.
Yeah, exactly. Pretty much what happened. But, yeah. All right, so we're back. George Strait we were on break for a long time.
We're listening to George Strait.
We're talking to, don't forget, next week, week from today, our live
draft,
Getting Sports
draft,
with Drunk.
Draft.
Fantasy draft. It'll be
Nice souls.
It'll be the five of us here. White Tea Souls, Machcine Washable, the Red Baron, Hostess Cupcake, the Riddler. Rita, who's currently got a hair bun going on, weird thing going on.
Kind
over
of
there.
A Cousin It vibe going on over
yeah,
there.
Yeah, she's... and then J-Mart will be making the...
Special guest.
Long anticipated...
Don't get ahead of ourselves.
No, he's coming. He said he already called it at work. The Mass, Chris Massey. And then first time guest...
Eric.
Stole his thunder just like that.
You know, he was looking right at me. Sorry.
Well, yeah, you're the one that bangs him more than anyone else here.
I don't know. Kyle
doesn't bang him. They don't. No. They're like a happy married couple that sleeps in separate rooms. They just get along. They don't bicker about anything.
They just get along.
Kyle, you all right over there?
Yark.
The Phillies are going to lose to the Pirates.
Yep.
So
what's the score right now? 6-2?
4-2.
4-2. How many times you guys had the bases juice tonight?
None.
How many times you got runners in scoring position with less than one out, less than two outs?
None.
And you guys aren't winning?
Yeah.
Yeah, you guys usually lose when you have a lot of... I watched a game one time where the Phillies had the bases loaded with less than two outs three times in the game and scored no runs.
Yeah.
I couldn't believe it.
Boy, 2 games back of the wild card after tonight. Tied with the Mets.
Hey, hey.
Ho, ho.
I like that.
All right, so let's talk fantasy football.
All right,
coming off our draft,
the Red Baron really wanted to talk fantasy football, so I'm gonna let him take the reins.
Well, I had a private conversation with Kyle today.
It was like 2 seconds about
nobody else got that joke.
One thing, like, there's more than to talk about. There's sleepers, man.
Right, there's a lot to talk about. We're in what is the height of fantasy football. Like, the drafts are happening now. I don't think anyone's really drafted prior to last week, right? I think it'd be too early.
There were drafts happening. Yeah, we used to do it wicked early, and just we had to shoot that down. Yeah.
I think we do it at a pretty appropriate time.
We actually were still kind of early this year. Usually we do it like 2 days before the season. We usually do it on like the Tuesday before week one.
For what?
For our draft. The last 2 years, we did it the Tuesday before week one.
For what, our friend group one?
Yeah.
Well,
yeah.
It
we wanted to do it next weekend, but
yeah,
it
just
didn't work
the timing,
out.
Yeah.
Well, it coincided, too, with kind of like a softball, because we knew everyone was together and this and that. But that worked out fine. A lot of fun.
I was more shocked that everybody showed up, but...
It would have been funny if I had to, like, call in.
John L. on Facebook is Raiders! Exclamation point. Like, yeah!
No.
No?
No.
But why not? Well, besides us being Steelers fans, the obvious reason, you know, Brown and all, but hey, this guy's pumped.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah. Raiders exclamation point. That's not a sad thing. Right?
Raiders.
All right. Come on, give some enthusiasm.
Raiders!
There we go. Other teams matter too, Souls.
Yeah. Meet the Lions.
Boo.
Anyway.
Browns.
I found this sheet here, and it I guess is the top 200. This is the fantasy football calculator. I'm sure you've heard of it.
No,
I don't know what makes it a calculator, but I guess if we wanted to break stuff down by how you do the league. We got a PPR league set up here. It's kind of what we're doing. I think that's a very popular option amongst fantasy football players. I know you guys probably Riddler and Souls have played in 2 QB leagues before.
You have as well last year.
Did we play? Oh, yeah, in our GSWD one. So that was my first time, so I didn't remember it.
And if you're Vinny, you've played in the rare 5 quarterback league. And didn't draft one good one.
That's right.
Oh, he has Russell Wilson.
Did he get Russell Wilson?
Yeah.
I can't remember where he first.
Bless you.
Excuse me. Thank you.
But we would talk about some guys who may be sleepers or guys who are, maybe busts. So, Kyle, do you have some people in mind? I'm going to scroll down a little bit on our list here.
Well, we're going to stay away from the top probably 20 guys.
Yeah, that's
20, 30 guys.
That's fair.
Well, in terms of sleeper?
Yeah.
Okay. Well, yeah, I agree with that.
Well, not buzz. Like, there's obviously going to be some fantasy buzz.
So, we got some middle of the road. I'm going to say middle of the road for players right now. We're going to have guys like Brandon Cooks, Melvin Gordon, and Mark Ingram, I think are... Well, Melvin Gordon and Mark Ingram is kind of an intriguing talk about. Ingram, the new scheme there, playing in Baltimore. a featured guy in New Orleans.
You kept saying Melvin and Ingram, and I immediately thought Melvin Ingram.
Well, that's what I mean, too. Let's get him involved. But Mark Ingram playing there in Baltimore with their multi-running back being a quarterback situation there. So what do we kind of anticipate from him?
It's a tough team to kind of evaluate because we don't know what we're going to get with Lamar Jackson. I mean, I think he's going to be their primary runner.
Shout out to Dave Sanderson tuning in.
So it's tough to kind of gauge where to put Ingram because even if he's the starting running back, I still think he's the number two running option there, which is a weird like dynamic.
Well, and it's interesting because he played very well in New Orleans, no doubt. But this guy is a very traditional running back, and it's kind of the way things are going now. Especially as a fantasy owner, you want the guy to be the pass catcher, too.
Well, you need it,
right? It's kind of to the days of like imagine having Jerome Bettis as your in fantasy. It's like it's not super ideal. Favorite player ever, but like he's not going to go out there and have five receptions in a game for you.
He's a tough pick because there's just a lot going on there. Like they I think they're still going to use all their other running backs as well. So he's not going to get all the touches.
Who's still there?
I got to look at it, but I know they had like three guys last year.
Well, I mean, like Alex Collins is gone.
Yeah, they had Dixon, who was primarily the lead back,
and Gus. Forgot about Gus Edwards.
Edwards, yeah.
He kind of broke out a little bit, though. But, I mean, Buck Allen's gone.
Is he?
Yeah. I'm not sure where he went, but he's not on the
he's Ravens. Not on anybody's fantasy radar, so it's okay.
But, I don't know. I mean, I think Ingram's going to be the starter, and he'll have work. But I think he's going to lose a lot of the goal line work to Lamar Jackson. I think Jackson's going to be running a lot this year.
Right.
So, it's tough to kind of gauge, like.
So, but do you at all, you guys, anticipate Ingram being kind of like the safety blanket at all? Not necessarily. I mean, as a guy who's going to come out of the backfield to catch passes and a dump off thing, but I just mean like, do you think they're going to run the ball more? Just you know, running back behind quarterback type plays. Are we going to see that? You think? And he's just going to get a lot of touches that way, or do you anticipate Jackson just running all over the place?
It's going to be Jackson. I think Jackson's going to get a lot of, like, play action, like, bootlegs to scoot out or just designed runs. I mean, to me, Ingram is, like, at best a flex. Like, I don't think you can play him as, like, one year starting running backs. There's, I don't know. I personally don't trust him this year as a fantasy option.
Yeah.
He is talented. I mean, we've seen him. He's a talented back. I just don't think the opportunity will be there.
Right. And he's getting older.
Why are you putting in quotes?
Well, I don't know. He's
getting older.
Right.
Still a Heisman winner.
That's true. Very, very true.
You can actually join us in a couple weeks on Spreaker when we talk about Heisman winners.
Yeah. Souls winner.
I said everything I needed to say about him.
All right. Fair enough.
Let me ask you, in the rankings of, we'll call it like flex / tier 3 running backs, is Mark Ingram Souls or something else?
Something else.
Souls.
Something else.
It's always been something else. All right, this is a...
Paul or probably,
or it was a Paul or Porpoise, the original.
Paul or Porpoise.
This is a hot button issue for this room. Derrick Henry...
I just don't see why you pick him.
Oh, I mean, I see why you could pick him. I'm not, like, for me, Derrick Henry, and I think this will kind of go on everyone's radar, Derrick Henry is nobody's RB1, but if you're in a position to pick, like, let's say you have, I think a good example would be, like, let's say you have, like, maybe, like, a 7 or 8 pick in a standard 10-person league, right? So by that time, you've lost all the top three guys, and then probably Gurley, You know, maybe not, you know. But, like, at that point, you're probably going to be looking at, like, David Johnson or Gurley, right? And then from there, when you cycle back through, you might be looking at, like, a Joe Mixon, but you're probably going to go with one of those top receivers that are still available, right?
It's kind of a situation I ran into last night.
Right, and so it's something, but it runs into the lines where you have a long snake to go back through, especially if you're eight. So by the time it gets back to you, you're sitting there looking, and you're like, okay, you're like, I'm going to probably pick another receiver, maybe get, like, you might still get, like, a Philip Lindsay or something like that. By the time it gets back to you in, like, your fifth round, Derrick Henry's still available. It's not a terrible option to go with, to have for a depth spot. I mean, even if it's just a couple week fill-in, a flex fill-in. I mean, Derrick Henry is not by any means, he's not going to be a 3 point a week guy.
To me, Derrick Henry's a guy that you would put in your flex and hope he gets a touchdown. Because he's going to be their, you know, their goal line kind of power back.
I think he's going to be their featured back.
You think he overtakes Deion Lewis this year?
Yeah.
Well, that'd be cool, because I like Derrick Henry a lot. I think he's a talented back. It's just they haven't given him the opportunity I think that they should. I mean, if he's the featured lead back, then I think you can put him in almost every week.
He scared me. To me, he's a lot like Eddie Lacy was.
I think he's better than Eddie Lacy.
I'm just saying, like, he's the type of running back that he is. He's a power back.
Yeah, he's a power back.
And if you give him a lot of carries, he's going to get a lot of 1-2 yards, kind of get, you know, taken out of the situation, because it's going to be like third and seven. Or
see, the difference I see is Derrick Henry is a power back with some wiggle. I mean, he can shift and avoid the cut. He is a power, like, he's a big guy. He runs hard. But, I mean, he's got enough wiggle where he can make guys miss and rip off chunks. I mean, we've seen it in games where, you know,
yeah,
he almost looks unstoppable.
I think we're in agreement, though, for fantasy. He is definitely not a one or two. He's definitely a guy that worth having on your roster, but probably in the flex type.
Again, I mean, I agree, but I just, if he's a guy, if he's going to be their featured back and he's going to get the 15 to 20 carries a game, then
that's not a featured back, though. That's a split back.
If you're getting 20 touches a game, that's your lead guy.
Again, 15 to 20. Like, your lead back is usually going to get you 25 to 30.
Well, I agree, Souls, but I think sort of because the way the NFL is now, it's so pass, you know, happy that...
Well, he's on a team that's, like, built to run.
Right, yeah. I mean, that
and
is
if you can't get it done that way, then, in my opinion, he's not worth taking.
But that's what I mean. If he's the guy that you're going to give 20 touches a game, then I think Derrick Henry is absolutely a startable player almost week in and week, because the Titans want to run the ball, and he's a guy that can do it. He's not a great pass-catching back, so that limits him, but I think if he gets that 15 to 20 carries a week, he's going to put points up.
Yeah.
And I think,
I mean,
he'll
even
get the goal line,
even if he just gets one reception for no yards, even if he just, regardless of yards.
Yeah.
Even if he gets a reception and 40 to 60 yards and a touchdown a game, that's worth a start.
That's what I mean. That's what I'm saying.
Double-digit points. I mean, anybody who can average you double-digit points is worth starting.
That's right. I think this year, like, if we think he's going to be their lead guy, I think he'll have the opportunity.
Well, I think there's more potential for him to be the lead guy, too, because you look at their quarter, their QB1 and QB2, they're both injury-prone guys. So as regardless of Mariota knowing the system or Tannehill knowing the system...
God damn it, was there.
Right, but like because of the injury prone, and especially with Mariota losing his mobility feature ever since he got hurt, like, you look a little bit more at that downhill runner versus that outside the tackle, like, RPO guy.
Very true. And Carl, too, let us know anybody that you think is kind of a fringe fantasy players. I know you're an avid player, and actually he's pretty good.
I'm trying to pull, it won't let me see the comments.
Oh, really?
Yeah, I'm not sure why.
It's weird. Well, I figured we can stay on the running backs for a couple more guys.
Yeah.
Here's a guy I'm very intrigued about. I had him towards the tail end of my losing season last year. Philip Lindsay, guy who's going to be the starter in Denver. Proved, you know, he's worth it. In my opinion, I don't know what that Broncos team is going to shape up to look like.
I think the word for him is potential this year. Because now they have a quarterback that can spread it open.
Odd thing you said there.
Not liking it, but it's true.
Really crack those legs.
Well, it's true because, you know, Case Keenum was a 5 to 10 yard type guy. Now you have a guy that can throw downfield.
Say his name, Kyle. Come on.
No.
I didn't even pick up on that.
Say his name.
Okay.
You started to, and then you bailed on it.
So. I didn't even lose my train of thought.
Flacco can throw downfield. Come on.
Better than Keenum. Better?
Flacco's better than Keenum. I agree with you.
All right. Whatever. We'll go with that.
So, Philip Lindsay, to me, is where he's being projected to go in terms of running backs, and everyone knows in a 10-team league with two running backs, like that's the bare minimum. Very rarely are you going to be in a league where there is less people and less running back positions to fill. There's always two, if not three, with the flex. It gets tough, especially to find consistent ones. Philip Lindsay did have a great year last year before he got hurt. There is a lot more on the ceiling side for him than maybe a lot of these other later type round running backs. However, he comes with a caution sign for me, and that's because Denver loves to use the whole running back family. And we have seen, Mock likes to make fun of the Bears, but go down the list of all the great running backs or games that, like, running backs that have had great stretches of games for the Broncos since Peyton Manning started playing there, and where are they now? No Sean Marino.
He kind of just felt that, like, he was, he signed with the
right,
Dolphins.
Right, but no Sean
like...
Marino, and then it was, and then after no Sean Marino, it was, who was it? Fuck, I can't remember his name.
Well, they had, what's his face there?
CJ Anderson.
CJ Anderson, there was
CJ,
another guy.
CJ, but I'm saying, that's what I'm saying, they've run through this thing, and a lot of people are really hyping up Royce Freeman. So it's like,
well, the hype behind free, I mean, you got to remember, Philip Lindsay was an undrafted free agent who just kind of burst out.
Right, but
Royce Freeman was a high draft pick.
Right,
so but, so I understand the hype.
Real quick,
but there's the hype. Right, but that's a lot of hype coming off of Philip Lindsay wasn't undrafted that blew up, but at the end of the day, he blew up. I mean, the guy had an amazing
year.
He did.
Yeah.
So, but what's it take? Does it take one bad game? Does it take a game where Philip Lindsay, game three, maybe Philip Lindsay keeps getting stuffed and Royce Freeman breaks out a couple of big runs? Now is it, does it switch from, you know, 20 to 25 touches for Lindsay and 15 for Freeman to 25 for Freeman and 15 for Lindsay?
Right. Well, we kind of, not to cut you off, we kind of saw that happen last year where Lindsay had his couple of breakout games and then he became the lead guy and I forget what it was, maybe like week 5 or 6. And Freeman was only getting his 7 to 9, 10 carries. And he was doing kind of more. So then it started to switch where Freeman was getting more, but then he fell off and like Philip Lindsay exploded again.
Yeah. So Carl thinks Freeman is going to overtake Lindsay, which we're kind of touching on this exactly being the case. And as a fantasy owner, I had both those guys. And. It kind of, you know, Freeman got hurt as well, but it kind of worked out in the sense that where, what am I trying to say? Lindsay had more yards and receptions. Freeman was a guy kind of getting the touches near the end zone, and he was getting the touchdowns. So it's the type of thing, if you're going to draft these guys early, which I don't think you would because the running backs are just better, you know, earlier in the list. But if you're going to take one, take the other. Have them both on your roster if you're going to
well,
go that route.
In a lot of leagues, Royce Freeman's not getting taken. And I think a big part of that is because the Broncos have said Philip Lindsay's going to start this year. He's going to be the go-to back. And he said it's not even close. Like I was reading like one of the articles like on fantasy, and he said that the competition's not even close right now. Mm-hmm. The other running backs in Denver haven't even like made a step in the right direction. They've been terrible. And if that's the case, then Philip Lindsay's obviously the easiest choice to pick from. And he also has the pass-catching ability that you like.
Right. Real quick, because Carl had mentioned this in the Facebook.
Also have
here.
Him in 90 different leagues, so kind of want him to be good.
Right? He has Damian Harris as a sleeper this year. I don't know if you guys want to talk about that a little bit, touch on that.
That's the guy from the Chiefs? Is he the guy from the Chiefs? Okay. Behind... what's his name there?
No, he's the lead back.
Damien Harris?
Yeah.
For where?
Chiefs.
Who's the guy I'm thinking of on the Chiefs?
I don't know. There isn't any. Carlos Hyde?
No.
I don't know who you're thinking of.
God damn. Hold on.
All right, but anyway.
The rookie?
Yeah, what's his name?
I don't know.
There's another running back. The name is escaping me.
But anyway, Chiefs anticipate them to have another good season. You know, that's what we envision anyway. And we know that Mahomes likes to throw the ball. And we're not exactly sure, now that the roster has kind of been shook up a little bit. Not much, but shook up a little bit. What we're going to kind of see from that squad.
I'm thinking of Damien Williams.
Oh.
Isn't that what we're talking about?
No, we're talking about Damien Harris.
Oh.
So, I think we're wrong, because Carl just said Patriots.
So. Oh, then, I don't know.
That's right, the rookie drafted to the Patriots.
Okay, I'm sorry.
I
don't think so.
Damien Harris is a guy, I mean, getting a lot of buzz around him, but I haven't watched him play at all, but I mean, from what I've seen and heard, there's a lot of hype behind him, but
got two guys in front of him.
Those Patriots running backs.
Next guy up.
Nothing like a nice game of roulette.
Who they drafted in the first round last year, I could just give up on him.
You know what though? I don't think they give up on him, but this kid was drafted for a reason. This kid, he was what, second or third round pick. So I mean that's still high draft capital, and Sony Michel is hurt a lot. He had another surgery done on his knee this offseason. I mean, that's a guy that tends to not stay on the field.
Yeah. Well, it's tough to call him a sleeper, because we just talked about the Patriots. So whoever's good at the time is going to have that wave of.
He might play that one game, or like fucking, what's his name?
Jonas Gray?
Yeah.
Yeah. And fucking break the out. Practice.
But then, like, but they still have James White, who Tom Brady loves. You're not going to get rid of him. You're not going to sit him. He didn't really get hurt that much.
Carl says when he's right, he wants to make sure we let him know that he was right.
Yeah, it's fine, but I just don't see how they would just let a third running back jump.
Because the Patriots do it all the time.
I know, but I think they're so high on Michel.
But again, we see the Patriots do this all the time. Sony Michel can come out week one, rush for 150 yards and three touchdowns. And guess who's getting the ball week two?
God, really
not hope, Sony Michel. Really
hope that doesn't happen.
But really, like, they do that all the time.
No, I know. I just really hope that doesn't happen. That would really suck.
You know, it's just...
Can the Steelers win at least?
No.
Then no.
But the Patriots running back roulette wheel is awful when you get involved.
We'll talk about one more running back, unless there's somebody you guys really want to talk about. But I really like the Austin Eckler discussion, a guy who had a stretch of games that he was effective in.
It depends on Melvin Gordon.
Yeah.
That's just it. Austin Eckler is worth taking in the 10th round, 8th to 10th round. Melvin Gordon's still going before Eckler.
Right, of course.
The chance on Gordon playing is worth more. I mean, is Eckler going to play well? Yes. Did Eckler perform well when he got his touches in San Diego or L.A.? Yes. But the minute Melvin Gordon decides that he's ready to come in and play football, he's getting the number one spot. It doesn't matter. It doesn't. I don't think it. Honestly, I don't think it matters what Eckler's doing for production wise. I don't think Connor could have not got hurt last year, and kept playing the way he started off the season, like week in and week out for 8 straight games. If Bell said, "I'm here to play," Bell would have been number one.
Sure. Keep in mind, though. I mean, I agree that Gordon comes back, he's immediately the lead back again. But last season with Gordon there, I mean, Eckler still had like his own standalone value. I mean, he was still averaging like 10 points a week. That's not, you know, blowing your team up, but I mean, if you're averaging 10 points a week out of your flex, I mean, you're happy with that. If you know this guy's in, he's going to get me 10 points. That's what he's going to do. I mean, he's a pretty like safe flex play pretty much, even when Gordon comes back. So I mean, I think Eckler's a good play this season. If he perform, I mean, they have that other, what's it, Josh Jacobs, is that his name? Kyle?
The other
Chargers
Justin,
back.
Justin Jackson.
Justin Jackson. It was a JJ name. But, I mean, he's a guy, too, that's pretty talented. I mean, so.
Jacobs played for the Raiders.
That's right.
The guy they drafted, right?
Yeah. But,
Yeah, give me a shot.
All right.
I'm owed one as well. real quick, because Carl is talking with us. He wants to kind of know about what you anticipate for Kyler Murray. He picked him up.
He's a big hit or miss. I have no, like, there's no.
I don't think
the boomer bust applies to Kyler Murray. The reason I say that is because Kyler Murray has, he's not coming into the Josh Rosen thing. Kyler Murray was the guy that they wanted, and it seemed like Kyler Murray was the guy the front office wanted all along.
Yeah.
They got the coach that they wanted to go with Kyler Murray, and last year was just a big experimental, hey, let's do this, and if it goes really, really well,
then we're
ahead of schedule. But if not, we're going for Kyler Murray. And Kyler Murray has a sure thing in Larry Fitzgerald. They went out and they got Michael Crabtree, who can be a red zone threat still and can be a somewhat stretch the field type of guy. Yes, he's aged. He's lost his quick step. But Michael Crabtree always fights for the football, always fights for extra yards. And if David Johnson can come back and play at 75% of the running back that he was 2 years ago, he's got an amazing out-of-the-backfield option. Plus, didn't they still have who do they have at tight ends? Farian Jenkins?
No. Ricky Seals-Jones and Charles Clay.
Charles Clay, that's what it was.
He was the two last name.
Right. Well, but Charles Clay has been, you know, he's not going to be the guy that's going to go out and do what, you know, yes, Greg Olsen. No, he's not. He's not going to do what Zach Ertz and Kelce, you know, he's not going to take over games. But Charles Clay is a very good vertical between the hash threat. Charles Clay is also very good at staying in and blocking. And Kyler Murray has the scrambling capability, and he has what these mobile quarterbacks have in, like, what you had in Mike Vick, what you have in Cam Newton, what you had in a Randall Cunningham, what you had, got to try to find a white mobile quarterback.
Ben Roethlisberger.
In the prime.
But, like, but even still, like a Ben Roethlisberger, someone who could, like, move around in the pocket and escape and things of that nature. There's somebody always, what makes Russell Wilson so dangerous week in and week out is what can make Kyler Murray dangerous is you're going to see Kyler Murray pointing out and calling the play. And then the ball's going to get snapped. And 5'6", 300-pound guys are going to stand up, and you're not going to see Kyler Murray anymore. And if you take your eye off of him for a second, you can lose him in the shuffle of bodies because he's small. Like look at running backs that had that success. Small running backs that did that. Tariq Cohen has success with that because he gets lost behind the line of scrimmage.
Darren Sproles.
I mean,
Parker.
Jerome Bettis.
They call him a bus for the reason.
The short bus. He's the short bus. But I mean, so I don't think the boomer bust thing applies. I think he's going to have his woes, but from a fantasy standpoint,
I think he's going to be effective.
It doesn't matter. If he goes out and throws a pick every game, that's negated with 10 yards rushing.
Yeah.
He's going to get 10 yards rushing every game. So, I mean, if you're drafting a team and you decided to wait until, like, 14th, 15th round to get a quarterback, I don't think it's the end of the world.
Not at all.
Not at all. Not by any means. I think Kyler Murray has more sleeper potential than bust potential, much like I think the other quarterback I wanted to bring up was Jameis Winston. I think Jameis Winston has a lot more boom than bust capabilities this year. He's playing on a contract year. He still has his favorite target in Mike Evans. He still has Godwin. He still has O.J. Howard, who's a huge red zone threat and can be a big body in the middle of the field. He's got running backs that can produce as a unit, no standout individually, but a unit that can play well. And not to mention, they brought in Bruce Arians, who's a great head coach.
Lucky bastards.
Jameis Winston has a lot of potential this year. And if all Jameis Winston has to do is just learn to not throw the picks. And he did better with that in his second tour in Tampa Bay last year. Because they did Fitzpatrick, Jameis, yeah. Fitzpatrick, Jameis. The second time around, Jameis was better with his ball security. If he can bring that sense of ball security into this season with this new look coaching staff and the weapons he's familiar with. Because the offensive turmoil that that team had was that DeSean Jackson was very vocal about not being a favorite target of Winston's. He loved playing with Fitzpatrick. Well, DeSean Jackson's gone now. Mike Evans is his favorite target. He likes Godwin. O.J. Howard's a big body threat. Jameis Winston likes the big guys.
Eat that W. You gotta eat that W. Worst hype speech. So you see his teammates in the back just like, what? We're... You want me to eat what? Winston is a guy that, you know, I've been burned by him twice now, so I was avoiding at all costs. But, Kyle, I hate you.
Sorry. It's getting to that point of the baseball where it matters.
But,
baseball always matters.
Winston is absolutely a guy. I mean, for everything Paul just said, personally, I think after this season, Winston's just going to permanently be a backup somewhere.
No, he won't.
Tampa wants to give him the money. That's why they brought Bruce in. They brought somebody in that can kind of like make him like go up another level. Tampa wants to give Jameis Winston the money. They want him to be good.
He has the potential. He has all the talent to be good.
And that's what I mean.
But I don't think he'll be the backup. Tampa will pay him.
Here's my opinion.
He might be that backup in 2 to 3 years if he can't hone it all in, but we're going to see Jameis Winston starting for the Tampa Bay Buccaneers until at least 2021.
So figure if they go out with all the weapons and this, and he wins 6 games, they pay him to stay on as their starter?
It depends on what happens.
Did the defense give up 400 yards a game?
Because their defense is pretty bad.
But right, and their defense is pretty bad. Did Mike Evans get hurt? If Mike Evans gets hurt, that changes the whole complexity of that offense. Did Jameis Winston go out in a 6-game win season, but did Jameis go out and throw 38 touchdowns and 7 interceptions? If he went out and...
I tell you, their defense would have to be really bad if he did that.
No. Not necessarily. But you see, things can be skewed all the time. If Jameis Winston goes out in the first 3 weeks and throws 5 touchdowns, what did Fitzpatrick do? If Jameis Winston goes out in the first 3-4 weeks and throws 3-4 touchdowns a game, he's already sitting on the bad side of 20. He's looking at 16-17 touchdowns. No. That means over the course of the season, he's throwing an additional 16 touchdowns. I mean, we saw it. Look at Ben. Ben's a gunslinger. Ben always puts up yards and always puts up touchdowns. But how inflated were Ben's numbers when he had those? The 2 games, including that game we went to against the Baltimore Ravens, where he just decided to throw for 537 yards and like 6 touchdowns in back-to-back weeks.
That was dope.
I'm just saying, like, does that symbolize the quarterback he was for the year? No, because he didn't throw that all year long. But at the end of the year, when the contract is being offered, it's what are the final numbers?
Interesting.
And out of the two quarterbacks out of that draft, Winston, I think, is still way up here. Mariota, I think, kind of lost everything he had going for him.
My thing is Mariota hit his stride a lot faster and looked more promising. But then when roadblocks were thrown in front of him, he kept running into them. And now he's kind of sputtering. And I dare anyone to give me an argument as to why he's not sputtering. They brought in Ryan Tannehill. Not just to be a backup. As a security purpose and probably to start some games. Mariota...
He will get hurt.
Jameis Winston shit the bed. Like, it was started off okay. Shit the bed. And now he's kind of getting this second coming. It's up to him to make something out of it.
Yeah.
What else you got, Kendall?
Well, I was wondering if you guys wanted to talk on Kyle's favorite player, Baker Mayfield, at all, about what his fantasy potential is this year.
Potential is very high.
So, do you...
Results are very low.
So, do we assume because of the squad around him and what we kind of know, does he not fall into the sleeper category. He's either a boomer bust guy.
I don't think he's a boomer bust, but I don't think he's sleeper because there's a lot of talent around him. Yeah. But he's still the guy that's got to deliver the football,
right?
So I mean, he definitely has potential to be one of the most hated quarterbacks in football this year because if he doesn't perform well, a lot of good picks got wasted.
Right. Yeah. It's one of those things. I mean, I honestly think Mayfield can finish top five in quarterbacks this year. And it's completely dependent on the team around him. I mean, he has more offensive weapons around him than most teams. I mean, their offense has a lot of options. And it's only going to get better halfway through the year when Kareem Hunt comes back. There's no reason why Mayfield shouldn't be putting up like big numbers this year. He's got to watch turnovers, but the team around him, I mean, just between Landry and Odell, I mean, those are two great receivers. I mean, Landry's got some of the best hands in the league, and Odell's a top-tier receiver. Nick Chubb's a stud, and I think Njoku's kind of slept on as a tight end just because he hasn't been used too much yet.
Nick Chubb played like 9-10 games.
And had 1,000 yards.
You're right. But how many times have we seen a rookie running back do that and suck?
So is James Conner going to suck?
No, he wasn't a rookie.
But he played one season.
Played two.
He played one season
he
as a starter.
He got to learn from Le'Veon Bell. There's a big difference.
Kyle, he played one
Here's
season.
Here's my thing. The Cleveland Browns traded away their best offensive lineman for Olivier Vernon.
Okay.
You don't think that's going to affect them at all?
I'm not saying it won't, but you're saying that Nick Chubb isn't good.
I'm not saying
he's a guy
that
played.
I'm saying he has a lot of bust status written all over him. I don't think that offensive line is as good as they were last year.
I think Nick Chubb is good enough.
They got rid of their cornerstone offensive lineman for aging defensive end.
I believe he started 9 games last year and finished with 991 yards.
One of the best offensive linemen in football. And they got rid of him for nothing. So now you have to replace the right side with either a rookie, because they didn't bring anybody in, offensive lineman-wise.
So where do you think Chubb finishes?
I don't think he finishes in the top 10.
I'm saying, like, stat, like how many yards does he finish
I think with? He gets 800.
800 with what for?
5-6 touchdowns. Because you said it, again, you said it yourself. They bring Kareem Hunt back. So there goes his fantasy value.
Okay, so say Chubb finishes, we'll say 800 yards and 5 touchdowns. What does Kareem Hunt finish with? Because he's going to have the second half of the year, so someone's going to still have that production.
How long did he have, 4 games?
8. For 8.
8 games, Kareem Hunt's up?
Yep. So, I mean, their running back core is going to have production. Between those two guys, you're going to have at least 1,200 yards of rushing yards. Because even if Chubb has 800, Kareem Hunt's going to get 400. In 8 weeks.
Okay.
So, I mean, the talent is there. Chubb is a good pass-catching back. So is Kareem Hunt. I mean, these guys are going to have touches. So even if Chubb finishes with 800 rushing yards, he's going to have, 400, 500 receiving? Over the course of a whole season?
Probably not.
I don't know what he finished with last year off the top of my head. Kendall?
500 seems a lot. Especially with Odell, Landry, and apparently Njoku.
And Njoku's a good tight end.
He drops a lot of passes.
He's a good tight end if he's used properly. What did he finish with? I know he had 150 last year. All right, so 500's a little high. So even still, even if he finishes with 300, because again, he only started half the year last year, so I mean, to think he can end with 300 rushing yard or receiving yards isn't far fetched. I mean, Nick Chubb is a good running back. They traded pieces away last year because of Chubb. I mean, Carlos Hyde wasn't doing much, but I mean, they paid him a lot of money to come to Cleveland, and then traded him away. Chubb is talented. I mean, I still think he's
worth picking in the first round?
Tail end first round, yeah. I think so.
No. Not even close. You still got all those receivers standing there.
But receivers in fantasy, the league's so pass heavy. I mean,
but it's not though, because after the fifth round, you're kind of like searching for the right guy.
But it's easier to find a receiver than it is to find a running back.
But is it?
Yes, it is.
Because if Tony Pollard comes out, then I just got a steal with the last pick in the draft. If Zeke Elliott doesn't play.
You're talking about a guy that's holding out for a contract.
Okay.
If Zeke comes back tomorrow, Pollard is useless.
You're right. But is he worth the gamble?
In the last round? Yeah.
Okay. So picking up with a guy like Jay Ajayi, is he worth the gamble?
Kyle, you're talking about Nick Chubb being drafted in the first round. You're talking about gambles in the last round.
I'm getting to it. Just hear me out. Because you're saying that it's easier to find receivers than running backs.
It is.
100%.
It's 100% easier to find a wide receiver than it is to find a running back that's going to be reliable in fantasy.
Taking the chance on like drafting Nelson Agholor or like DeSean Jackson is like versus like Jeffrey and Ertz, there's a lot less of a gamble and a more likely payoff than like the gamble of drafting Jay Ajayi over a running back that's guaranteed all the touches for at least 8 weeks.
But what if he's not guaranteed 8 weeks? What if they brought Kareem Hunt to take over?
They didn't bring Kareem Hunt to take over.
But he's guaranteed all the touches for 8 weeks. It doesn't matter if Kareem Hunt takes over on week 9. It doesn't matter if they cut Nick Chubb on week 9. He's still guaranteed all the touches
Johnson's gone.
And in a pass-happy offense where there's a lot of down-the-field threats, so there's going to be a lot of check-down options.
All right, but I just don't see him being picked in the top 10, being worth your wild. Maybe late second round.
I mean, this season, I would take Chubb over Gurley because Gurley's going to be limited.
Not.
He is.
Read the reports, my friend.
It's already come out. They've already said it. He's going to be limited this year.
The guy's getting 8 to 12 reps, the backup. That means Gurley will be in for the rest of the game.
It's still the preseason.
They said Gurley had not had any problems.
I mean, how did he go from arthritic knees to where he couldn't play at the end of last season to now he has no problems?
Because he's had a year off.
He didn't have a year off.
He didn't have a year off.
He had an extended season. He played more football than...
Yeah.
But he didn't actually play in those games.
He was hurt with arthritic knees.
Okay, but they, if you read the report, they said he had no problems going on right now.
I mean, again, this
he
going
no,
into
he has
this
no
season,
problem with it right now because he's not getting tackled.
Yeah.
He's not putting pressure on his knees. I mean, if I blow out my back, when I got drunk and sprinted up Kendall's Road and blew out my hammy, I had zero problems at all. I was 100% when I was walking down to the end of the driveway to get the mailbox. But then when there was a creepy sound in the woods and I had to run back, there was a lot of problems. Like, there's a big difference between, like, he's got no problems. He's moving around fine. He's training. Getting the football handed to you and taking a cut on the turf and then running a 10-yard simulated outside the tackle run is a lot different than getting the ball and then immediately having contact 3 yards in and someone trying to take their 260-pound frame plus the force of all their muscle mass to drag you to the ground, and the only thing keeping you upright is your knees.
He's played in preseason games, so they said he looks good.
He's played in preseason. I mean, he played a drive per game.
Okay, then we can say that about anybody.
Well, no, because he's got issues.
So you're telling me you'd rather take Nick Chubb over Todd Gurley?
I'm saying this year because...
I would take Nick Chubb over Todd Gurley this year.
And it's only because I think Gurley's going to be limited this year. I don't think he's going to give the production he gave last year. I think they're going to limit his carries more to probably maybe try and save him more for the... Because he was gassed by the postseason.
Plus, the other thing, too, is Todd Gurley can look good all he wants in the preseason. And I understand the reports. Like, it's very important to say those things. They're going to say the positive things, not the negative things. But he went from having the summer off to not playing pretty – he probably didn't play – I don't know what he played, but he probably didn't really play week one preseason. Week two, he maybe took a drive. Week three, he probably took 3 or 4 drives. That's a lot different than having 30 runs a game for 7 straight weeks. Anybody can look good coming back from injury if they're only running the ball 3 times in 1 drive.
Okay, so let's go down the list. On this thing, he's ranked 11. Okay.
Oh, for running backs?
Who?
Nick Chubb.
Okay.
For running backs.
Okay.
All right. We'll start with one. Obviously, the first three. I'm not going to go through that. We're going to take the first three over him.
Yeah.
Right?
So, you're saying what? Barkley, McCaffrey, Kamara?
Yeah.
Okay.
All right. What did they have before Kamara? Oh, Elliott. Would you take a chance on Elliott over him?
Would I take the chance? No. Because I don't know what Elliott's going to do.
I would, but that's only because I think there's more. Elliott's more likely to play.
I think he's more likely to play, but even still, I mean, when you're drafting in that first round, that's not the time to gamble. I mean, we saw it last year. Who gambled on Lev Bell last year?
Kendall.
How'd it pay out?
Pretty well.
The first round is not for gambling. That's where you have to pick your stud, the guy that you are going to rely on week in and week out.
Here's the thing, if you don't gamble and they do come back, you look stupid.
No, you don't, because you still have an elite running back that you were able to draft.
Yeah, I mean, what do you mean you look stupid? So, like, if I decided...
If you took Nick Chubb at 5 over Ezekiel Elliott...
But I wouldn't take Nick Chubb at 5. That's a dumb comparison.
I said first round. So...
Right, but...
What's the highest you would take Nick Chubb?
Let's see. Hold on. You guys can banter. I'm just thinking names in my head. I don't want you guys to just be...
So I'll keep going with the list.
Well, here, I would take Kamara, McCaffrey, and Barkley.
Yeah.
Over him. I would take Hopkins over him. I would take the chance on Elliott over him because I think Elliott's more likely to play.
So the interesting, I'm going to go off of what happened to me last night. I was the 8th pick. All the running backs that should take and people I wanted were gone. So I had the option of either taking what I thought was one of the better receivers available or picking running back. I didn't pick the running back, and I just picked the receivers in back-to-back rounds.
And you took Julio Jones.
What I'm saying is that I wanted
I'm just thinking. I'm
right,
just...
I took Jones, and I think I took Keenan Allen, I think
so.
But I really wanted the running back, but I didn't value the people that were available enough to pass up on the receivers, I guess, is what I'm trying to say.
But, like, going back to your argument, though, about the Elliott thing, like, if I passed up on... If Elliott was available to me at the 5th pick, and I picked Chubb over Elliott, and Elliott played week 1, yeah, that would bite me in the ass, but I wouldn't do that. Like, for me, that would be like, oh, I didn't pick Elliott because I wasn't sure, so I picked David Johnson. But, like, the argument, like... The more you're comfortable is like Nick Chubb versus Melvin Gordon. There's zero certainty of Melvin Gordon.
Yeah.
At all. Like, they're not even close.
I would take Nick Chubb over Melvin Gordon. I would do that in a heartbeat.
Yeah, right. I would take Nick Chubb over Joe Mixon.
You know, that was going to be my next question.
I would take Nick Chubb over Joe Mixon. If Nick Chubb was still there in the second round last night when we drafted, I would have taken him.
Yeah, I was going to take Joe Mixon. Paul, you took my pick like 5 times last night.
I'm sorry.
It's the nature of the beast.
Oh, hey.
There was a lot of times I'm like, oh, I got this guy queued up, and I watch Paul. I'm like, ah, that's son
of
a
bitch. This has Joe Mixon ahead of Nick Chubb, this list.
Okay. That's fine.
David Johnson, would you take Nick Chubb over David Johnson?
No.
Hmm.
Don't go off just last year.
Well, I mean, what do you base it off of then?
Because you know how good he is. You know what
I know
do.
David Johnson is good, but I mean, he was hurt, then he was below average last year. He
wasn't below average. He just didn't have an offensive line.
But when
he got the quarterback in there, he got a lot of catches.
But what I'm saying is again, the first round is not for the gamble.
He's not a gamble.
But again, he was hurt, and then he was kind of whatever last year. So is David Johnson good? Yes, David Johnson is a very talented back.
Came out strong.
I'm not denying that. But I think I would take Chubb over him because I think Chubb is in a better offense than the Cardinals. And I think he'll have more opportunity.
He might be in a better offense, but David Johnson's in a better spot. Kyle Murray's going to check down.
So I have...
But again, I mean, we just talked about
he's
a
premier passing catching running back. You know he is.
I'm not saying he's not. But again, I think Nick Chubb is going to have all the opportunity in the world this year, being on an offense like we just talked about, having Landry and Odell to stretch the field, and Bakers has that check down, and Chubb, I think, is a better between the tackles runner than David Johnson. I mean, that's my opinion, but so if I had to decide between those two right now, I think I would take Chubb over.
If you're going off the statistics and the rankings, Nick Chubb, no, is not a top 10 player to be drafted. But there's more that goes into fantasy than just the rankings. People go off gut feelings all the time. Kyle, how many times have you passed up on somebody because you didn't think that he was going to be that good?
A lot.
All the time. What round did I get D.D. Westbrook in last night? The 14th round? I'm pretty sure he was like the 20th projected receiver.
Yeah.
I mean, it happens all the time. Everyone has gut feelings. Yeah. Certain players, like certain people don't draft certain teams, things like that, of all that, like that type
yep.
of. But there's things that go into it, more into it.
Because I would take a Brown. I would take a Brown.
What?
Like, I know I would never take a Raven, except a defensive coach.
But what I'm saying, though, is like.
Way to walk that back.
But, like, it all goes off. It's all based off of opinions. Everyone's opinion is different. I mean.
That's what it comes down
yeah,
to.
Opinions
fantasy,
are like assholes. Everybody has one. I mean, it's just.
This was a year that, honestly, I really wanted Nick Chubb this year. Like, really bad. But, I mean. I'm not going to take him over McCaffrey.
Oh, right.
No. That's what I mean. Like, at two, like it just it wasn't in the – but if I was in that
– If you were in that 9
7
spot.
To 10 range, I would have jumped at the bit to grab Nick Chubb, and I would have been happy about it.
Would you have
taken
him at
5? I don't know.
I was close to taking a running back at 5, but I didn't.
I'm trying to remember. You took Hopkins?
Yeah.
I probably would have, because
at that point the running backs taken were McCaffrey, or it was Barkley, McCaffrey, Kamara, and Bell.
Bell went 4.
Eric picked Bell.
Okay.
And Elliott went 6.
Elliott went 6. Jones went 7.
Yeah.
No, Jones went 8. Chubb went 9.
I'm going to be honest with you, Kyle. I don't know if I would have taken him at 5, but there would have been thought.
This is going to cause feather ruffles, and I know it, but the only running back worth discussion that was drafted, the only two running backs that Nick Chubb was drafted over that creates discussion are David Johnson and James Conner. That was who it is. But I think that Chubb falls into that category of those two guys in terms of potential for this coming year.
I think David Johnson
is a better back than both of them, light years better than both of them. I think David Johnson is... If David Johnson was given the same exact setting as Le'Veon Bell, I think he could have a better year than Le'Veon Bell. But there are question marks.
Yeah.
And David Johnson does have health issues. There are, you know, there's always those question marks. And so I think that those three fit into the same thing. So I don't think it's, you know, like, it's not far-fetched. And it also depends on how things go, too. I mean, you have to think about it, too. What if you're in a league where there's leagues, there's people with the mentality, it's all where people pick, too. Like, look at your dad, for example. Your dad hates waiting on running backs. If your dad was drafting 6th or 7th, say he was drafting 7th, and nobody took a receiver, say Hopkins was available. Now, this is your dad, not you giving insight to your dad. But if Hopkins was available, but, like, Bell went, Elliott went, and we'll say Gurley went, and he's sitting at 7... He would be looking at like David Johnson or James Conner, which would then open it up for the next guy to be like, well, there's not a lot left. Shit. Like, the next guy is going to take one of them, so I should probably take the one I want. And then by that end of it, right there, by the time you get to your dad's next pick, Nick Chubb's probably gone. And, was it not first round? No, but 11th or 12th, close enough.
Yeah, I doubt it took Conner. I'm just saying. He took Conner at 4 yesterday.
Wow.
So, you're going to sit here and argue with
this. Well, no. He only took Conner because he didn't want Bell and he didn't trust Elliott.
You took Bell in the other league.
He did. Yeah, we did. But I convinced him. And we're about to trade Bell. For Barkley.
Who's going to do that trade?
My brother.
All right.
Straight up?
No. We're giving him Julian Edelman.
And who are you getting back?
Some scrub. Forgot who.
I'm vetoing the shit out of that trade. That's not fair at all.
So Larry wanted it. Larry offered it.
It's fine. I'm still vetoing it.
Oh, man.
You guys want to keep rolling? You want to take a break? We can keep going. I mean, I have a question. I just didn't know if you guys want
to. Yeah, we'll just keep rolling.
Yeah. Yeah.
So I was curious.
We'll go to 11:45 and then we'll call it.
You know what the highlight of last night's draft was?
What's that?
I didn't get Kyle Rudolph. That was the best thing of the entire draft.
Yeah, you know what the best part is? I can't wait for Kirk Cousins to throw to him a lot.
Yeah,
but like not do anything else. Like, because like think about it,
he'll pick him up too.
Oh, I plan to pick up Kyle Rudolph.
Because like think about it though, like week one, like Kirk Cousins goes out and throws like
listen
four picks
week one. Rudolph's getting two touchdowns, and then he's going to be on my roster.
100%.
I'm saying, like, but Cousins is going to throw, like, four picks, two touchdowns, and, like, 287 yards. And, like, and Rudolph's going to have 187 and two touchdowns.
Oh, yeah. He's dropping a 50 burger.
Hey, Paul, this is the one out, bases loaded opportunity that you're talking about.
Oh, nice. All right.
It's 5-5.
Oh, you guys tied it up.
Well, no, we took the lead, and then Josh Bell hit a game time home run. At least it was Josh Bell. Who was batting ninth?
Kendall, your question?
Yeah, so of these three quarterbacks here, Mitch
Trubisky. I have a thing about that. Not to get off the subject this, sure. But for baseball. When someone's batting ninth, I don't think it's like a bad thing to bat someone ninth.
It's not.
Other than having to wait through the full rotation for them to get it, they're essentially just kind of like your pre-leadoff guy.
Second leadoff.
Well, no, he pinched it and just stayed in the game.
That's usually what it is. Your ninth
batter.
Right,
but, like, think about it, though. Like, in today, we've had this discussion a lot. Like, a lot of teams bat their power hitter two now.
Yeah.
So, like, imagine, like if you can do, like so I'm just going to go based off the White Sox because I know the rotation. But, like, so let's say you were going to put, like, Moncada at two and you're going to bat Tim leadoff. If you drop Elhoy to nine, now you're putting Elhoy and Tim, two guys that get on base, ahead for Moncada, who's a home run hitter, and then Abreu at three, who drives and runs. Like,
That shift started a few years ago.
Yeah, now it's like 5, 6, and 7 at the bottom of the order.
Yeah, like if you're batting eighth, you suck.
You're the worst.
For the pitcher.
Yeah, right?
All right, Kendall, your question.
Of these three quarterbacks here, Mr. Trubisky, Josh Allen, Jimmy Garoppolo, who's going to have like the breakout? Who's going to be the biggest bust?
In fantasy?
Fantasy, yeah.
Damn it, Rhys Hoskins.
In your guys' opinion. I kind of equate these guys. They're not... Talent-wise, they're all different. They're different, but they're kind of in the
Allen
middle
will
road
be
path.
The Allen will be the bust of the three, in my opinion, in terms of fantasy. Yeah. I think Allen will be the bust of the... So when I say bust, I mean, I think he'll be the worst of the three in fantasy. I think Garoppolo will be the best. I think Garoppolo is a more natural arm, like, throwing the football. He's got Kittle, you know. The team has made the receiving core that they have work. We know what we have in Garoppolo to a sense. There's still room to grow, but like we know what kind of like quarterback style we're going to get from him. There's still a lot of question marks on Trubisky's decision making, but he is mobile, and he does get rushing yards, and he does spread the ball around to the open guys. Josh Allen just still doesn't have anyone to throw to.
Zay Jones, baby.
I think between those three, I think Josh Allen rushes enough to be better than Garoppolo. Garoppolo, I'm not sold on him whatsoever. I mean, we've really seen nothing from the guy.
Who's the third one?
Mitch.
I got it.
So, Garoppolo on the Patriots was supposed to start those four games, got hurt, signs a monster deal with San Fran, played a few games, got hurt. So, I mean, we really haven't seen him. I mean, I'm personally not really sold on him. Josh Allen, I think, passing-wise, might not do much. He's got a big arm, but it's still kind of developing. But I think he'll run enough to make up for it.
He's got Cole Beasley now.
Oh, that's right. I forgot about him.
Trubisky, I think, is the guy that's going to kind of be in the middle. And it's pretty much kind of for what Paul said. I mean, I think Trubisky has the potential to be a very good quarterback. His development seems kind of not slow, but sluggish, but I think he's getting better as the time goes on.
So you think Josh Allen will have more fantasy points?
I think Josh Allen will finish with more fantasy, and it's gonna purely be on the rushing. I mean, I think he'll have like 300 or 400 yard rushing game just because he runs. It's
Trubisky's gonna have the most points. because he can throw the ball and he can rush the ball. He's a dual threat quarterback. He has better weapons than both quarterbacks. I just think that he's going to be able to actually... I think he's going to have a good year this year. I think he breaks out.
Oh, man, Paul, that was pretty... That's got to be a bummer for you to hear.
What?
Because Kyle thought Josh Freeman was going to break out and Blake Bortles and Blaine Gabbert.
No.
And Landry Jones.
He's going to be like, damn, Ryan Tannehill. I'm like, oh, come on, Kyle. Say he's going to be bad.
Nah.
Garoppolo, though.
If this is the case, let's go Baker Mayfield.
Well, for 2 years in a row now, I picked Garoppolo strictly off of name alone. Oh, Garoppolo, I'm sorry. It's my accent. I'm from upstate. But I think you're right. In
upstate Wisconsin.
Yeah. And I think in non-fantasy, too, I think if he doesn't do anything this year, it's like, all right, well, then forget you. We're going to go just draft somebody or do something else because a lot of stock was put into him.
God fucking damn it.
Well, that's not... Yeah.
The one time you talk into the microphone, yeah. That's weird.
Well, they fucking did their usual let's not score the bases load one out thing.
Guys want to talk some receivers? I got to go to the bathroom, but I figured we talk some.
You want
to
take a break?
No, we're rolling. I'm just going to pose a question, or you guys want to just talk? And but we did running backs, quarterbacks, figured we talk receivers now. I'll scroll back up a little bit. Because receivers are a premium as well. See here. Oh, here's a guy that's kind of interesting. Mr. Robbie Anderson, the wide receiver for the New York Jets. Presumably they're one, is that correct?
Yeah.
I think he's the only receiver on the Jets.
But
I think they still have a new one.
Yeah, right.
Is Quincy still there? He's kind of good.
Good for them.
Yeah, like he's like a just an average receiver that has good games every once in a while.
He has the targets.
I don't know. I think he'd just be like a 700-yard receiver guy.
He'd be a 700-yard receiver guy that has 300-yard games and two touchdowns in those games.
Well, I mean, you finish with seven, so what do you think? He'll be like a wide receiver two on most teams?
Yeah, like that's the best he's going to get. But he's number one for them.
No, I mean, so like on the average
he'll be a wide receiver two. Yeah, or flex. If he's your number, if he's
in your flex, your receiving core is really good.
If he's your wide receiver one, your receiving core is pretty bad.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I agree with you, Kyle. See, we can agree on things.
If Robbie Anderson's in your flex?
Is it Robbie or Robbie?
Robbie Anderson? I don't know.
I don't know, because I've heard both things on
TV.
If
he's in your flex,
if number 81 is on your team, he wears 81.
No, I said if he's in your flex, I think your receiving core is probably pretty good. Kyle said if he's your number one, your receiving core is bad.
Yeah.
If he's your two, then it's whatever.
And then you're everyone else.
Yeah.
So it's like, he's okay.
So Kyle, would you rather have Robbie Anderson or DJ Moore?
DJ Moore.
Yeah, me too.
All right, here's one, though. Would you rather have Robbie Anderson or Alshon Jeffrey?
Alshon Jeffrey. I wanted him so bad last night you took him from me.
I just feel like he's like one of those guys that everyone like always wants to take, but like I just don't know about that Eagles offense. Like there's just so many weapons that like...
Well, this is what's going to happen. Zach Ertz is going to march down the field and they're going to throw a lob pass and complete it. And then you're going to hit him with a slant.
Okay. No, my thing is though, it's just that, like, it's just like he feeds Ertz a lot, but like other than that, like it's like... Like, none of the receivers have, like, one receiver that's going to have, like, Jeffrey has a big day today, and then Aguilar is next week, and then DeSean Jackson's like, they all just kind of have mediocre days. It's really whoever gets the touchdowns.
Again, I think Jeffrey's going to be that wide receiver, too, where he's going to get anywhere between, 7 to 9 targets a game. Mostly, I mean, because, again, Ertz eats up a lot of targets. And
he might be my wide receiver one. I don't remember. I don't think I drafted a receiver before him. But I have Ertz, too, though.
But that's what I mean. Like, Ertz eats up a big time of the target share.
I thought about drafting Jackson and Aguilar and just starting the Eagles offense.
No, we took Vito out of the league.
Yeah.
But,
that's with running backs. Like, starting a whole offense is Kendall's move.
Yeah, it's true. But again, like if Jeffrey gets that, we'll say 7 to 10 targets. I mean, 10 is might be kind of high, but
he's always a touchdown threat, though.
He'll always be the touchdown threat, and he usually will end up with yard. I mean, he's not a ball dropper.
I feel like ever since he moved from Chicago to Philly, he is kind of assumed the more Dez Bryant role receiver.
He's a big bodied guy.
Catch the like the easy route, like you know, yeah. like separate because of your strength and your size versus your route running capabilities, and then be the big guy down in the end zone.
But you know, I think he's a guy that'll get you, say, 5 receptions for 50 yards. Again, I mean that's not totally far, and he's always a touchdown threat. So even if he's your 2 or in your flex, I mean that's 10 points with the potential at 16.
No.
To me, that's a good flex player. You know, even your wide receiver too. I mean, and he still, I mean, is a talented receiver that can go off for 110 yards.
There's things I always wonder, like why, how come Josh Gordon gets the nod to be up so high?
Because talent wise, he should be. If he just stops smoking pot for a season, hey, talent wise, he's a very talented.
He's
receiver.
Only good because he smokes all that pot.
I know. Just let him do it. I mean, really, like, he is a...
The NFL grants 1 medicinal marijuana card a year.
I mean, really,
Josh
like,
Gordon, irate that he wasn't selected.
He is an incredible... Think of the seasons he had on the Browns teams that were fucking terrible.
No, I know, but I'm just saying, like...
Think of the seasons he could have on that terrible.
That's right. I mean, if he could just stay on the field and not get suspended for once, especially in that, you know, now the Patriots offense, I mean, he can be an explosive receiver, and he just can't stay on the field.
That's just it.
But I do agree, he shouldn't be ranked as high as he is.
You think he should be?
I don't.
Right, like, for somebody that's, like, it's not, we're not talking about, like, the Elliott and Gordon thing, where, like, this is their first time, hopefully, and only time holding out, and you're not sure when they're going to play.
Gordon's going to get suspended.
No, but I'm saying, but like Melvin Gordon and Elliott, right? Like they're gonna play. You just don't know when and this and that. And
you
blah blah
see
blah.
The Popeyes thing that with Melvin Gordon.
No.
So he went to the Popeyes. Okay, this is very funny. He went into Popeyes to try that new chicken sandwich, and they sold out. And I'm pretty sure he told like the manager, like, "I'm Melvin Gordon. You're supposed to have this.
Yeah, get me one now."
You're supposed
Kyle, that was a beautiful rendition of that commercial.
I hope you, like, suck my ass later.
All right, moving on.
Yeah. So here's a guy. Oh, God. I just...
Chris Collinsworth.
I just Collinsworthed it, man. a guy who randomly always has, like, a monster game. And he never a high pick because he's always underneath Hopkins. But Will Fuller the Fifth.
He's exactly what you just said. He's going to get those big games, fourth. And that's it.
Is it the fourth? Is that the fifth? Oh. I thought Willie Snead was the fourth.
Will Fuller...
Oh, maybe it is the fifth, then.
Will Fuller, to me, is a guy that's very important to DeAndre Hopkins.
But do you think he's ever going to have that breakout year?
No, he's exactly what he is. He's going to get you those, like, 2 touchdowns for, like, 3 catches and 114 yards.
But, see, like... Yes. I agree. I don't think Will Fuller is super dynamic.
Oh, what you make out already.
On his own. I mean, don't get me wrong. He's a super talented receiver. But I think that his skill set makes DeAndre Hopkins better. Which sounds crazy. But, I mean, Fuller really can... He's a deep threat. I mean, he can stretch the field, and it just opens things up for Hopkins.
And you have to worry about him.
Yeah, because... If you don't, I mean, he is a talented receiver.
I mean, I could think of a ton of multi-touchdown games he's had. And the thing is, I don't know who ever really has owned him in fantasy.
He's like Ted Ginn, everybody but does. Can catch.
He's picked every year.
Yeah. He's Ted Ginn who can catch.
Well, hold on. He had a couple good years.
But, I mean, like, he's fast. He can get down. He's a good route runner, and he can catch. He can make the big play.
Mock $30 if he gets for college.
I couldn't
first
care.
Try.
Couldn't care any less.
Around the room, everyone gets $30. No
Louisiana
cheating.
State Tech.
No. No cheating. First guess, $30 if you get it.
It's Temple, that. Obviously.
Wrong.
Paul. What?
I hate this game.
Just first guess.
I don't want to do it.
I'm sorry. I believe I was right.
Guess,
give me my $30.
Guess Temple.
I don't want to do it.
All right.
Guess all right. Temple. You're not going to look it up right now.
I know it's Notre Dame.
No, it's not. right, but so I guess we're sort of in agreement about Will Fuller. So you
he's a great flex opportunity. If he's your second receiver, like we said about Robbie or Robbie Anderson, your receivers suck.
Yeah, I don't. Is that his first name, Robbie or Robbie?
It's either Robbie or Robbie. We talked about it when you were in the bathroom.
Either or. Like, Robbie Anderson, if he's your second receiver or your flex, you're okay. If he's your first, your running back better be fucking phenomenal.
All right, here's a guy who...
How about this? Sleeper, A.J. Green.
He's not a sleeper. He's hurt. He's going to come back and be good.
He is a sleeper because how do you know that 4 weeks isn't going to fuck him up?
Because he's a talented receiver. He's going to come back and he's going to be good.
Bust. Oh, okay. I'll do that now. Bust Tyler Boyd.
I disagree. And I disagree because Tyler Boyd was good last year with A.J. Green on the field. And as long as A.J. Green misses time, I think Boyd's going to be an explosive receiver.
I don't think people are going to figure him out. That's the only reason. I think people are going to figure him out and just, you know, they could double-team him. Because who the fuck else do they have?
But, I mean, they were able to do that last year. And he still put up big games when Green wasn't on the field.
Because, like, I don't think John Ross is healthy again.
Well, that guy's just fast. He's not very good.
Well, real quick, I was going to sort of include him in the conversation. Of these three guys, who do you think has like the most upside versus, you know what I'm trying to say, Tyler Lockett, Calvin Ridley, Tyler Boyd?
Tyler Lockett's going to have the most points.
He's had those points?
He's their number one receiver.
Well, right now, but do you think, because much credit to Doug Baldwin, you know, his entire career, how much do you think, you know, him playing no longer affects Tyler Lockett? Or you think not at all? Or you think he still puts up the same numbers, being the
So we said Lockett. What were the three?
Ridley, Boyd.
Personally, I think Tyler Lockett takes a step back this year. I don't think that he is good enough to be a number one. I know he had a good season last year with Baldwin on, you know, limited
time. Here's the only
time.
Thing about Tyler Lockett. I think he can play the slot a lot still.
But your number one can't be a slot guy.
He's not the number one on the paper. It could be David Moore, who sucks, but, you know.
I think Calvin Ridley has the...
God, I fucking hope so.
The most likely chance.
I hope his brother does way better.
Steve Ridley?
Oh, rookie for the Bears.
Just forget his name.
But
Chantel Williams. Ridley.
I mean, Calvin Ridley plays, I think, in the most complete offense.
Ridley.
Of those three.
Yeah.
I mean, you're in Atlanta, I mean, you have Matt Ryan, who's a good quarterback. He's the number two behind Julio Jones, and they have a good run game. Like, their offense can move the ball and will score points. And, I mean, Ridley's shown he can step up and make big plays, have the big game, and I think he's just going to keep getting better. So, to me, of those three, it'll be Calvin Ridley to score the most. Tyler Boyd, I think, will have a good year, but he may start to taper off when Green comes back or when that team just falls apart because they're bad.
What?
Just talking to the
mic. He's asking if you have Calvin Ridley.
Oh, like an early... I don't know.
You do.
Okay.
I was just curious.
So didn't remember 17 fucking picks?
Yeah, I was trying to make moves today, but my team's empty.
We're doing it tomorrow.
I usually have 6 waiver moves in before week 1, so.
Really, not this put year. Me back.
You have a lot of bench spots, so if you have a lot of waiver moves, you suck.
Well, it happens when you forget the guy's name you meant to draft and draft the other guy.
What's your fault?
I was so mad. As soon as I put the sticker, I was like, oh, no.
I picked Rashad Penny.
I did that a few years ago.
He can be okay.
Yeah, I know it's not a bad pick, but it's just not what I wanted to do.
He's a weird guy. I've met him once. He licks carpets.
What? Same dude.
That was all nonsense. What else you got for us, Kendall?
Let's talk some Evan Ingram. Actually, we'll move on from receivers. Get some tight end stuff going there.
Well, Paul has a very hard, heavy thing about him, so go ahead.
Another weird thing you just said.
Yeah. He's got a real hard dick for.
No, opposite, actually.
I just, I don't see why everyone, like, I've looked at a lot of, like, mock drafts and done drafts, Machcine washable drafts, obviously. But I'm not disputing his talent, and I'm not disputing his upside, but I've seen a lot of people and a lot of mock drafts online, you know, like DraftKings things, yesterday, things like that. But people, like, reaching for him, like, when, like, so, like, people see Kelsey go off in, like, the second round.
Everyone fucking panics.
Right, but then it goes, like, and then it's Ertz and Kittle. So, like, normally I don't go tight end that high, but, like, I wasn't happy with who was available, so I was like, you know what, I'll just go with Ertz. Let's get the tight end thing done and over with and out of the way. Then Kittle went next. And then Evan Ingram went. And, like, I just don't understand why on earth people are drafting him so high, not as a tight end spot, but in an overall draft. The potential is there. The talent is by far there. He's got size. He's got speed. He could be a red zone threat. He's got all those things that you want in a tight end, what you had in Jim Graham in New Orleans.
James Graham.
No,
Jim Speaking Graham. Of James.
But
Jim Graham.
But like, guy's overrated.
Yeah.
But, well, he has not actually done anything. He hasn't done anything. He might have had a few productive games, but he hasn't strung together productive games. He hasn't stayed healthy. And then even last year, he was a healthy scratch from some games. Or maybe not a scratch, but he didn't play, whatever the situation was. Like, I remember watching, like, I think it was in the Bears game. Like, there was, like, Evan Ingram didn't take a snap the whole game. He was suited up and ready to go. They're just like, nah, fuck him. We don't need him.
I understand your argument. I think Ingram gets picked higher, similar to other tight ends, because people panic. I mean, you see it a lot of times, too, when, like, the first defense goes. Everyone's like, oh, got to get my defense. Like, but it happens most with tight ends because there's such a big fall off. I mean, Kittle blew up last year, but, I mean, typically it was Gronk, Kelsey, Ertz. After then, who knows? I mean, it was kind of a crapshoot. Ingram, to me, this year, I think, is ranked higher because of his talent, and I think he'll get more of the opportunity. Especially, I mean, if you're a wide receiver for the Giants, you're probably hurt right now. Or you're suspended for 4 games. I mean, I think he's got the opportunity, and he's a tight end, but he's built like a receiver. Like, he's a wide receiver. So I think we're going to see him get a lot more targets. Especially Odell's gone, so I mean that huge target share now has to be divided up, and
yeah, but that kind of happened last year though.
Games that Odell wasn't on the field, Ingram had good games.
But like in the beginning of the year, Odell didn't play, right?
But he didn't string together good games.
Was it the beginning of the year he didn't play? I think he missed like the first like three weeks.
I don't think so. I don't. Well, like, I'm not saying you're wrong, but I don't think so. I don't remember.
I think he missed a game in like the first 3 weeks. I don't remember. I could be wrong. I probably am wrong. But fuck it, I'm going with it.
I'll stand by it.
Good man.
The argument that because player X isn't there anymore, so the ball has to go somewhere, will never be enough for me to draft somebody.
No, what I mean,
never
I mean,
be enough for me to draft somebody that hasn't proven it.
But think about it. I mean, even if you look at a team like the Steelers, Brown was, what, 25 to 30% of their passing offense? Yeah, that 30% of that offense has to go somewhere.
Yeah, it's going to change this year.
Well, well, Kyle, if he's 30% of your offense this year. But, I mean, that production has to go somewhere, or at least the targets have to go somewhere.
I was talking to Paul like after the draft day, so we're on the way home, and I'm like, so, like, the first tight end went, and everybody just panicked, and everybody just started picking him. I'm like,
it happens all the time.
I'm like, the fourth tight end went, I'm like, I'm not picking one until later on. That just means somebody's falling to me.
That's why I always end up with Kyle Rudolph.
That just means somebody's going to fall to me, whatever. I'm going to let it ride. And Lindsay ended up falling, so I picked him. Marlon Mack fell, I picked him, and Aaron Jones I picked. All in a row. A lot of running backs, but those are, like, guys that I could use.
Right.
So, I'm looking at his game log from last year. Okay. So the first 3 games of the season, he was 2 for 18. Then he had a great week 2, 7 for 67 and a touchdown. Then 1 for 19. Then didn't play in 3 games. Then came back 2 for 16. then went 5 for 25 with a touchdown, then didn't, then had the bye week, then went 4 for 46, then had 66 yards on 2 receptions, 1 big reception.
I remember that game.
Then he didn't play for 2 more games, and then he finished out the season great. 3 for 77, 8 for 75, 6 for 87, and 5 for 81, and a touchdown. But the last 4 games were good, but there's no string of consistency.
Like, I picked Ebron this year.
And there's healthy scratches in those games not played.
It was healthy scratch while he was still nursing his knee injuries, though. But you gotta, like I said,
if you can't play, don't suit up. End of story. If your team, you have 53 guys on a team where you have to have at least 24 different starters. At least 24. Between your kicker, your punter, and 11 on each side of the ball. Now, you have to have a backup for at least every position except the kicker, punter, and quarterback. So now that leaves you with 19. 22 and 19, Souls, it's 41.
Yeah.
Okay. Then the rest of those guys fill in on the special team side of the ball. That's where that comes in. I refuse to believe that somebody suited up, but they were just like, we'll just have you suit up for an emergency. If his injury was bad enough to the point where they couldn't play him, why would they play him in an emergency situation? Doesn't make any sense.
But again, I mean, you're saying he hasn't strung together. You just read off the last 4 games when Odell wasn't on the field. He had over 70 yards. And
was it the last four games?
I'm pretty sure it was the last 4 Odell missed.
So it was something wrong. It was like that, beginning, end, you know.
But.
Well, so, I mean, we mentioned, you know, there was some games that he put together some stuff. But actually, I drafted him last year with hopes that I thought that this was going to be the year, that the past year was going to be the breakout year. And injuries did happen, but. He wasn't, as far as fantasy goes, he wasn't a top tight end.
So let me ask you a question then. So where would you, let's go off his consistency basis for the 4 rounds. Where would you, what's the highest you would go for Evan Engram? What round? Fifth? Sixth?
No.
I'd say 7, 8.
I'd probably be in the 6 or 7 range.
Yeah,
because without the touchdowns, he's not putting up the points that you're getting from the top tier tight ends that he's ranked in. Because he's ranked in the Ertz Kittle range, that's where they have him ranked.
But again, for this season, is that what you? That's
yeah.
But again, that's what I'm saying. Like,
but the argument was that, so when Odell was off the field for those last 4 games, donuts for touchdowns. He's the biggest guy on the field. He should be catching touchdowns. Who's the red zone threat when Beckham's not there?
But again, in fantasy for tight ends, I mean, if you're getting 8, 6, and 5 receptions for 75, 87, he doesn't need the touchdown to have a good fantasy week. If you're getting 12 to 15 points out of your tight end, that's more than most.
To watch him get drafted where he's getting drafted, if I'm going to draft him in the 6th round, he better get a touchdown. I don't give a shit if he's getting 5 receptions for 80 yards. I want the touchdown. I mean, if you drafted a receiver in the 5th round, would you be content with 5 for 80 every week? Nothing else?
Yeah. Because that's your wide receiver 2. If your wide receiver 2 is going to give you pretty much 15 points every week, I'll take that every day.
13 points.
Either, but I'll take that every with a potential for a touchdown. I'll
No touchdowns. No touchdowns.
But I mean, Engram has a potential for a touchdown.
It's just as he's getting drafted, like people are drafting him like he's Kelsey and Ertz. And he's not. He can be, sure, but it doesn't make sense to me. It does not make any sense to me. I've seen people pass up Mike Evans for Engram.
No.
I've seen people pass up.
If that, then that's people that don't know what they're doing.
But I've
Because that's Evan Engram going in the 2nd or 3rd round.
But I've seen all kinds of people get passed up. All kinds of good receivers get passed up. And running backs.
But that's the thing. It's because the fall off after tight end is so steep. It's.
But there are other good tight ends. That Like, it doesn't make any sense. Why is Evan Engram valued? Why is his potential in the offense that he's in have any higher of a value than Jared Cook's? Jared Cook has put together a lot of good seasons. Other than his tenure in the Rams.
Tennessee.
He was great in Tennessee.
Was he?
Jared Cook was great in Tennessee.
No, I thought they had Delanie Walker.
What?
What team did Delanie Walker play for before the Titans?
Jared Cook played for the Titans like a while ago.
No, I'm just asking.
Oh, Delanie Walker?
Wasn't he always a Titan?
No. I think he might have been. I think that's why Jared Cook ended up getting shipped out. Because they didn't need the 1-2 punch. But you're talking about a tight end that's a vertical threat tight end in the Saints offense. The last time they had one of those panned out pretty well.
Jim Graham.
Yeah. Or James Graham.
I feel like he was a 49er.
Delanie Walker. There was a fellow who played for the Titans who was also a Patriot. And I don't know if it was Delanie Walker, but I believe he was a tight end. That didn't really help anything. But look it up.
I would have said it right there.
So, Sol's mentioned it for a hot second. Eric Ebron had a pretty good year last year in fantasy and, just...
I was right. Had a great fantasy year.
I was right. San Fran.
Yeah.
For a long time.
I remember him, but whatever.
Wow.
So do we now how the way things have kind of panned out? No Andrew Luck, obviously.
I think the red zone efficiency goes. I think his touchdown potential goes up, but I think his yardage goes down. I don't think that Brissett's going to move the ball down the field through him like Luck did, but I think that being the big target that he is, especially if Brissett scrambles, that he could have a big potential in the red. I mean, I think I could see him having.
I don't know enough about how Brissett plays because there's some quarterbacks that just don't look the way they're tight ends.
I only picked him because of how good he did for me last year.
Yeah, I mean, and there's no fault in that. It's just I don't know Brissett's game enough to know if he looks at a guy. I mean, Aaron Rodgers doesn't really throw to the tight end.
Do whatever to Michael Finley.
But I mean, really, like he's a guy. He's had good tight ends there. I mean, he's got Jimmy Grant. He doesn't really utilize them. It's just some guys don't look that way.
Right. Also, hope he does okay.
Who?
James Graham.
Oh, Jim Graham.
Guys,
both those tight ends are on my
team. James Graham. We're not doing this James Graham thing. So stop.
I like James.
It's
Graham.
Jim Graham.
James. No.
Listen,
Jack.
I don't care if he's not good, but at the Jack time Graham. Where I picked him, the value's good.
Kyle loves to just like root for everybody. In my division, but I say one good thing about Baker Mayfield, and he's ready to fucking throw a goddamn conniption about it.
What? No.
I hope Jimmy Graham does well. I love Matt Stafford. Kerryon Johnson, super underrated. I
never said that.
Yes, you did. Or, sorry, Galladay. Sorry, Galladay, super underrated.
Get your facts right.
Oh, my bad. Sorry. Calvin Johnson's the greatest thing since sliced bread. Harrison Smith's the best safety in the NFL. I think that Dalvin Cook could be really good. Yes, you have.
No, I haven't.
It doesn't matter. You have this tendency to just rip apart my division for all these great players that you just love so much. And I have one opinion about a Brown, and you're just like, you're a fucking piece of shit.
Sure.
But we anticipate LeBron. Being down fantasy point wise,
I think he'll be down. I don't even think it's because of the quarterback. I mean, he finished with what, 11 touchdowns?
Yeah, he finished with a lot.
So I mean, to match that production is not an easy thing. So
unless
he
goes back to Detroit.
Well, no, then he'll have 3 touchdowns. But I mean, to match 11 touchdowns, and he had I don't know what he had for yards, but I mean. 10 yards.
Maybe he likes Jack Doyle.
Jack Doyle rules.
But, I mean, really, like, let's pull it up. He had 750 yards last year with 13 touchdowns. To match that production is a
steep order.
Yeah.
For sure.
And, I mean, so I would expect him to dip anyway, but I don't think he'll fall off.
All right. Figure we'll talk one final tight end before we move on?
So that I can kind of pose it. Would you rather have Eric Ebron or Evan Ingram? E-E or E-E?
Hmm. Ebron.
Souls?
Ingram.
Paul?
Ebron.
See, I would take Ingram. Not as a job. I would take the opportunity. I think he'll have a better opportunity, but.
All right, well then, we will skip on the rest of the tight ends. It's kind of.
What do you mean?
Do you have something you want to talk about?
Seals Jones.
Delaney Walker.
You want to talk Delaney Walker?
He's going to roll an ankle in week one and be doubt. I mean, come on. That's what he does every year.
All right, well, Mock already said it, so.
So according to this list, he's the 22nd.
Here's what's going to happen.
He's a good, like, late round pick.
He's going to have 80 yards in week one, but he's going to get hurt catching a touchdown, and that's going to end the season.
Come on, man.
That's what he does.
No, it's not. It's the first time I get hurt for like that.
He hurts his ankle every year.
Was it his ankle this time? Actually, it might have been. I don't remember. I'm going to roll with it.
What do you got for us?
What about Big Bad Vance? What do you think?
Vance McDonald?
I think he's going to suck.
He's going to fumble a lot.
Kyle, just like last week, you told me he was going to be really good.
Yeah, I know, but he drops a lot of passes.
Yeah, I mean, I
that's stiff arm, though.
That's stiff arm, though. You got the stiff arm down.
I would draft him as a backup tight end all day.
100%. A lot of people are going to start him because there's not a lot of good tight ends.
That's right. I think he'll be a serviceable tight end for fantasy. He'll get you 7 points a week.
Jordan Reed.
No. Concussion. Dude, already.
He had such the potential.
Yeah, but that guy's going to have CTE at 31.
Can you just stop and let the guy live his life?
I mean, get him a bigger helmet.
He's not saying anything disparaging. Just he's hurt. He's hurt. We get it. All right, so.
You got another concussion, too.
So, this position is not a position at all. It's a group of positions. The defense. Who's going to be a breakout defense this year, fantasy football-wise?
Well, Seattle week one.
See, defense to me is something I try and do in chunks and try and play ahead. And
so you guys all...
I try and go matchup.
Do you guys all do matchup?
More or less. I mean, if the matchup...
depends who you get.
Yeah.
If you can get, like, the Bears or Jacksonville or Dallas, then no.
So, like, this year...
I ride it out, you know... Like, for example, so, like, if I had the Bears defense, the weeks that they play, like, the Rams or, like, the Kansas City Chiefs, like, if they're playing to par, if they're playing to what they should be doing, then I just keep it. Because, yeah, they might get scored all over, but they're probably still going to get sacks. They'll probably still get some turnovers. They're still going to net you some points. Like, same thing with Jacksonville. Like, Jacksonville might get scored all over, but they're still going to get 3 or 4 sacks in a game. They're still probably going to get a turnover. You know, same thing with, like, Dallas, but...
Well, you see, I don't play week to week. I just don't. I don't want to. I don't care to. I just want a team that can.
You pick the Chargers defense every year.
For the most part, I picked the Steelers before. I picked Seattle when I won.
So like this year, like I said, I normally go matchup, but like this year, I jumped up and I took the Bills. I think the Bills will have a good defense, and I'll kind of ride that till they don't. But again, I mean, if you see the good matchup and you can spare a bench spot, I mean, there's no reason you can swap one out, you know, for whoever's playing the Dolphins, really.
Yep, that's what I did week one.
Whoever's playing the Dolphins, play that defense.
Week two might be the same thing.
But, I mean, as far as that, like, I'll try and, like, plan ahead.
Keep them when they play the Steelers, too.
I'll try and plan ahead sometimes. You know, if you see a matchup coming... and you can spare the spot, you pick up, you know, a defense for next week or whatever. But for the most part, it's a week to week. You play the matchup.
Josh Doctson might be traded.
Why is that news, Kyle?
I just got it.
I know, but why is that news? Like, why is Bleacher Report telling us that? Because who cares?
He led all Washington receivers in yards last year.
With what, 500?
Better than 400.
All right. Well, real quick, because you know you guys, you know, have good knowledge.
Detroit defense. Say,
if you were a guy like myself who doesn't like to do week to week, and let's say you couldn't get what's perceived as the top defenses like the Bears, the Rams, etc., what would be a team defense that you think would be serviceable enough to get you through a year, in your opinion?
Well, if Derwin James is playing the fucking
Chargers. So what are the defenses you want to take off the list that you're considering? The like, how many?
Well,
the top what?
13.
Top 5, I guess.
All right, so Bears.
Rams.
Vikings.
Probably.
Jacksonville.
Cowboys.
And Cowboys
weren't drafted.
Do they have considered a top 5 defense?
I don't think so. I think they're considered like 7-8.
Hold on, I'm trying to find it.
Can you sort by position there?
Nope.
You sure?
I got you.
I think it's by the type of...
If you click that POS, click defense.
The top 5 defenses, as by Bleacher Report, are Bears, Ravens, Jaguars, Cowboys, and Bills.
So remember, this site I'm on doesn't mean anything. I've never heard of it.
So, all right. We'll use Paul's. And what were your 5?
My 5 were Bears, Ravens, Jaguars, Cowboys, and Bills.
All right.
Which I think is fair, because honestly, I don't know what everyone's like big hype about the Rams defense is.
They're just gonna get a lot of sacks.
Yeah, but they got thrown all over last year.
No, I agree.
They got lit up. I mean, if you get 4 sacks and give up 40 points, your points netted are 0.
I mean, I guess they have like the takeaways. I don't know. But because they added Clay Matthews and Eric Weddle.
So I mean, off that list that Paul gave,
aging,
I mean,
ass motherfuckers.
Paul's list that, I mean, if you're looking for a defense for the year.
Regardless of the list, I say the Eagles defense.
I mean, you have the Eagles, the Chargers, and the Vikings. Those would be the 3 you could look at to play for a whole season.
If you're going off Kendall's list, well, Cleveland, I think you could too. Again, they might get scored on a lot, but they're going to get sacks and they're going to get turnovers.
I'm going to sound like a homer, but I think the Steelers defense has a lot of potential to keep all year.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, I hope so.
Because I know it's just preseason, but all 11 starters played yesterday. And they said the first string had 4 sacks, a safety, and a forced fumble.
Yeah, but the starters play for the offensive side?
Yeah.
And what team was it?
Titans.
All
right, so for fantasy, and you can include what the top list is, you know, what Paul's list was in this one. He said they were very similar. Who would be an overrated, like, hey, to be the whatever defense picked and it's not going to pan out? In your guys' best opinion, approximation.
Vikings.
Seattle.
Hey, man. It's just a week one thing.
Ravens.
Again, just a week one thing. Saints.
You guys can elaborate.
Yeah, I'm looking at the Saints, but I'm also kind of looking at Denver. I mean, the Denver defense, it's still good, but it's not what it was. I don't know. I don't know if I believe.
Oh, Houston. Houston, I don't think, has a good defense. They have good players on defense.
Well, they have a great pass rush.
And I think Jonathan Joseph's like 94 years old.
Barring health.
You're right. Barring health, you're right. When their guys are on the field, I mean, they have a very powerful pass
rush. But
they still
get lit up a lot.
It's one of those things where their secondary isn't great, but if the pass rush is doing its job, you can mask a poor secondary with a good pass rush. I mean, the Giants won a Super Bowl doing it.
I think the Chargers could even be a bust. They lost their safety for the year.
Who?
Derwin James.
Did they?
Yeah.
What'd he do? ACL?
Nah, fucked up his ankle. But that's a big loss.
Yeah, I didn't know that.
You know?
Yeah.
I get, like, the Chargers have Joey Bosa, and they have good guys, but I just don't think there's another safety that did what he did for that team last year.
Eddie Jackson.
Well, he's a Bear, man. And he's going to have a killer year.
Probably not. A lot of hype. Plus, you drafted him, so he's going to suck.
No, who I draft usually does good. Who I say doesn't.
Well, nice of you to come back here.
Hey. Yep.
Tennessee even could be a good sleeper.
They always have a good defense.
But again, I mean, is that going to be a defense that's just on the field a lot?
Oh,
it
yeah.
Doesn't matter. They still get the job done.
Even the Colts, maybe, have a potential to be good. They were good last year.
Yeah, that defense turned around real quick. So I remember 2 years ago, that was like, hey, don't even go near the Colts defense.
Well, they have good pass rush. They have a good safety. They can convert turnovers.
What about defenses you should never pick up?
Oh, go to the Dolphins is probably one.
Nah, Tampa.
Well, I'm only saying the Dolphins because they're going to start on their own 13 every time.
Wow. Mm-hmm. So on that list, Atlanta is the last ranked defense.
They're a sleeper. They got all their guys back. Keanu Neal.
Keanu Reeves. Keanu Cat.
You know, I was watching something about Colin Coward the other day.
That guy sucks.
He was doing the top 10 best lefties of all time. And Keanu Reeves made the list.
I hate Coward so much.
I thought that was funny as shit.
Why didn't you make the list?
Because he played Shane Falco. Oh. He was above Manny Pacquiao.
All right.
Who's also lefty, apparently.
Interesting list there, Coward.
It's called Southpaw Cuff.
Even Carolina has a good
like, defense. Especially in boxing, it's called Southpaw.
Like, the Carolinas, the Atlantas.
Like, they like to use Southpaw, like in baseball and stuff, but, like if you're a boxer, like, Southpaw's, like, that's, like, a word for that.
That's a stance.
Yeah. Do you know where Southpaw came from? Like, what city it originated in?
Chicago.
Kenny the Kid from Atlanta.
Karate Kid.
I'm pretty sure it originated from the city of brotherly love.
The Karate Kid. LA.
Yeah, Atlanta.
That's the city of brother.
No, that's the city of peaches.
The city of peaches. God.
I don't know where you get your facts, kid, but I like it.
Is Rebecca out?
Oh, yeah. Fast asleep.
Is there any chance that we could sign off and get out of here with her?
Oh, yeah.
Guys,
100%.
I'm going to appreciate this. Walk Off Woman by Sean Rodriguez.
Really?
Yeah.
No one appreciates that.
He appreciates it.
Oh, my God. Gross. I'm
That's
sorry.
That's a perfect time for beer reviews.
Yeah. Well, what are, like, the best, like, obviously, that's a dumb question. It's what they're playing that week. But, like, you can stream, like, Carolina, Atlanta, New Orleans. Actually, the whole NFC South besides Tampa.
But, yeah. Yeah.
Like, that's like why I think the streaming of defense is coming very high. Like, if Carolina's going up against, like, fucking Joe Schmo, pick Carolina up that week. And they have a capable defense of getting sacked and turnovers.
Streaming's very important. I mean, you can stream quarterbacks. Like, you don't need a set quarterback week to week.
Yeah, but it's nice to have that.
Well, yeah, it's nice to have the...
You don't want
to,
like, flush around with, like...
But, again, like, if you're
a
guy that...
The two water references, streaming and flush.
If you wait for, you know... And you don't get a guy that you can stream quarterbacks. You base on the matchup. You can do it with tight ends.
You know, I've never heard that term until just now. For fantasy streaming.
Yeah.
I never heard that.
It's like you pick up a guy to play him that week, and then you cut him.
Or you keep him. And get really frustrated the next week, and then cut him. Fucking asshole.
Care to elaborate?
I'm going to say, who are you talking about in specific here,
Kyle? There's a lot of them. I don't have a specific one.
All of them?
Mike Davis.
Hey.
I like him, but he was a dick to me.
Yeah, why'd you pick a Seattle committee running back?
Because last year they
Carson
had the thing.
And Penny weren't playing.
Yeah, but they still don't.
And they were both, and Carson was doubtful for that week. I was like, all right, I'll play him. I ended up playing.
So it's not his fault.
I get that. But they could have used him a little more.
Not his fault either.
Could have used him. Come on, man.
You're going to shit on... Okay, all right.
I'm not shitting on
anybody.
Can
I say one name for you?
Go ahead.
D'Angelo Williams.
Yeah, we should have used him more.
Hey, you pretty much kept our holes beginning of the season alive, but now you can go fuck yourself. Bye. Have fun in TNA or wherever the hell he is.
He wasn't TNA.
They did that to him twice.
Yep. They did. All right, Souls, how was your beers?
Great.
Okay.
Mock?
That's all you got?
I've already reviewed both of them.
Do it for me. I wasn't here.
Okay, this one tastes like pissed water, which is aka Bud Light. Not very good. Citrus was very good. I put it in my top three now.
Top three? Up there with
Two Juicy Duper. And Super Duper Double.
He doesn't know. Two Juicy's not in your top three.
It is.
There was a Two Juicy at the party yesterday. You didn't have one.
Was there?
Yeah.
Yeah, but that was also claimed to be off limits.
And also a lot of Red Dog.
You don't like Red Dog.
I do. No, you don't. I had six of them.
You don't like Red
no
Dog?
No way you had six of them.
I had none.
You had four, including the two shotguns?
Kyle was drafted, man. He had to be in the zone.
I had five.
Man. He had to lurk. Kept yelling at him for lurking around the table.
I know.
Well, I'm trying to help somebody because they were asking me for help.
Every Ooh. Time?
Massive.
No.
He did.
I don't buy it. Nope.
How was your beer, Kendall?
Excellent. I had two. I had the Summer Ale from Still Hill. Golden ambery in color. Aromas of bread, earthy, and floral. Which matched the flavor profile.
Bread, earthy, and floral.
Which matched the flavor profile as well. Very easy drinking beer, as most summer ales are.
Smelled like a Woodstock Wonderloaf.
Fairly tasty. I give it 3 stars. Sure, we'll get again. And I'm closing from another Still Hill here. Beer here. God. Mama's Imperial Little Helper, which I assume is an IPA. It's a double ale, but I don't know what that means.
It's an ale. You drink enough of them, they'll taste like an IPA.
That's right. 8% percent by alcohol by value. 8%, did I mention that? Straw
what was
color.
The percentage?
8. Oh. We're on Spreaker, by the way. Floral and bread notes. And
we're on Spreaker, by the way.
3 stars, we'd get it again. It's kind of very typical IPA-esque. It's good, though. I'll have it. If it appears in the fridge again. Thanks, Still Hill. Hope we visit you sometime.
Nice. Mark?
I had two Natagasserit lagers.
How are they each individually?
You know, the first one was better than the second.
Colder.
A little chillier. But,
A little more ripe.
You know, this is a beer that I used to kind of steer away from, and I'm not sure why. But it's good.
Because you have no merit?
I don't know why.
Because you're a slapsucker?
No. I don't know why. It was just always one where I was just like, I'll get something else. But now I see myself going towards them. And it's good. It's good. I enjoy it. Hi, neighbor.
It's neighbor.
I just see Paul over there looking at me.
I had the Rainy Days Band-Aid Blues Czech-style lager from Still Hill. It was a lighter style beer. I mean, if you had a Czech-style lager before, I mean, they range in quality, but overall in, like, general, like, taste profile, they're all very similar.
Yeah.
So, I mean, it had a little bit of the hoppiness to it, but nothing crazy, more malt forward. It was light. It was a very serviceable beer. It's stuck in here.
Blow on the bottom.
Don't you tell me what to do. It is 5.4% ABV. I'd get it again. You know, if I was looking for like a nice, like a kind of like drink three or four beer type of like thing, grab a four pack of this. Hey, besides Spreaker, where can they find us?
Nice. Be sure to find Spreaker. Us on Facebook and Instagram at Getting Sports With Drunk. Twitter is GSWD_4.
Make sure to use the hashtag GSWD for all your daily uses, whether it's finding us on Spreaker or watching us on Spreaker.
Subscribe on Podbean, iTunes, Google Play, iHeartRadio, Spotify, and
Spreaker.
Yeah.
You were trying not to laugh tonight.
I was, because I knew what I wanted to do, and I was trying to just get through it. Be sure to check out the Peter Pino Show Wednesday night.
On Spreaker.
On Spreaker also, from 7:30 to 10:30.
Hey, guys, we just got a check in the mail.
It's for $1.
Just stop saying it.
20
but,
cents.
But yeah, check out PPRN. Find them on Spreaker. Subscribe to us.
And on Spreaker.
On Spreaker. Everywhere. Spreaker. Find us. Yeah.
Closing statements? Anybody? Anything last minute to say?
I would like to give out Kyle's personal cell phone number for fantasy football advice.
203-980-1833.
What are you, Mike Jones? Like, come on.
I think that was Jeff Martin's Jones, number.
No, that's my number. Jeff Martin's is 203.
How about this? I want you to rattle off everybody that you've ever met's phone number. Go.
His mic.
I can get all four of you.
His mic. Mine's easy, and mine's always the one you fuck up.
Yeah.
What is mine, Kyle?
203-262-2952. Close enough, though.
No.
Close enough.
No, you know why?
Hey, is this Paul?
Because I have an 860 area code.
860.
So you can go ahead and call all that all you want, but you're never going to get me.
Paul?
Is it the right other number?
Paul, I'm out of work.
This no Paul. You stop calling.
No, Brady, I'm out, so.
That's my favorite. My favorite, especially like at midnight, he'll call you and just be like, I'm ready whenever you are. Okay.
I'll see you at 6.
Yeah, I just drew a bath, so.
I'll meet you at Cumbie's.
All right. Well,
no, you're not laughing.
Next week, make sure to tune in.
I got it right, by the way. Just 203.
We're hoping for an 8 o'clock sharp start because it's going to take a full 3 hours, no breaks. So it'll be a very
Kendall, no breaks.
Ooh.
If you leave to pee, even when it's not your pick, you forfeit your next pick.
That's not fair.
Rebecca makes your pick.
Ugh. I'll bring a bucket.
There you go.
Hold it.
And scotch.
Or you're not allowed to drink.
Just pee in your mouth.
All right.
Imagine that if we did the draft here and Kendall wasn't allowed to drink. I think he'd go nuts. Like, I think he would probably just
might
snap.
He pick better.
Oh, I'd pick marginally better.
Dude, there'd be one less charger to you.
Absolutely.
So, we're hoping to have a good time.
Mike Williams, by the way, just wanted to throw that out there.
There you go. I'm hoping to have a good draft next week. You'll be able to listen to it live on Spreaker.
Oh, I've got BB to it.
Until then, though, I'm your host, Cupcake the Riddler.
I'm Mark.
He's Spreaker Souls.
What the hell? You guys didn't do it.
Nah, I know, but I wanted you to say Spreaker Souls. I knew you weren't going to say it.
White tea sold on Spreaker.
Sheen washable.
Nope.
He's also on Spreaker.
Rebecca's awake.
On Spreaker.
She's not on Spreaker.
And I'm the Red Baron.
On Spreaker.
Yeah. Spreaker, 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 Spreaker. Yeah.